Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sun Sphere Tactical Attack Brigade Star Wars Legion podcast. I am Will, forces of evil in a bozo nightmare. I'm with Ryan, a shotgun wedding and a stain on my shirt, Slawoski, Ben, couple of couches, sleep on the love seat, Fowler, and Tim, I'm a loser, baby, so why don't you kill me? Hannon, I did all that for that joke. You're welcome.
You landed it so well,
you
too.
Know? Bravo, guys. Bravo. Good. Bravo.
That's all I'm doing this show, everyone. Goodbye. I'm retiring so now. I have nothing else. Like, it'll never get any better than this.
I think it can only get better from this.
That's because you think we need to be legitimate. And you're wrong.
This is where Will and I always agree. I love that joke, A Thousand Ways from Sunday. I've recorded it 6 more times. Love it. Love it.
He's so good. It's the singing of it, too, is what gets us.
Yeah, it's also the mono droning slinging.
Yes.
Yes.
This week on the 98th episode of the STABcast, battle reports from the Rocky Top Game Con. Is that a battle horn of tiny bears that I hear? And so much more.
Bears. Bears in the trees.
Man. Drop bears.
Drop bears.
It is.
I'll tell that story when we get there. I'll tell the story. Yeah.
The horn.
6 months of waiting and preparation is over. We got through Rocky Top Game Con this weekend. We had 51-ish amazing players and also Ben. And
yes, I was there. I was there.
You were also there. We pulled a lot of strings, and this thing is finally over. I don't have another tournament I'm organizing on the horizon, so I can finally go to Dagobah.
It was good. I'm super pleased. I mean, I really can't say more. Like, it was solid. It turned out beautifully.
It did. Yeah. It was a good time. Venue was great. People were great.
Yeah, so I just set up tables and sent a lot of emails and maintained a spreadsheet. You guys actually had to play.
I don't know if play Yay. Counts as what happened when I did, but I was there.
Hey, you played 5 games.
That's right. I should
five games happened to you.
That's a better explanation.
Listen, listeners, don't let Tim undersell you. It's not really salt at all, but like he actually had very good games.
No, they
that
were,
came down to a knife's
really
edge,
were.
And Tim just got on the wrong side of the knife's edge.
I was doing really well, like attitude wise, despite the numbers, up until that last game. That last game broke me.
Your usual Tim salt, but it would just be like a momentary blip of like,
yeah, yes. And then we're good.
Like,
we're good.
Whatever.
But that was the one.
It's always bad ending that kind of way. But we'll get there. What did you start off the day with? With hope in your eyes.
What'd you actually bring?
So my list.
We talked about this.
Yes, my list, and I actually really like this list. I stand by it. But it was Wookiee Chieftain, Clone Commander. A phase 2 with a comms tech and a comms relay. Phase 1 with fives. Phase 1 with a Z6. Naked phase 1. 2 naked barks. And a TX-130 saber tank with Ayla Secura in it. And then also the missiles and the high energy, I guess I should clarify, high energy shell missiles and the TLT. Which every time I said TLT, you could tell who the old X-Wing players were. Because we'd look at each other with a look of horror and say, no, not again. Not again. Multiple opponents, we had that moment of, oh God, not the TLT, please.
It does seem so very strange that the TLT is not the beam weapon.
Right.
Because that's what I would expect it to be in my head, but it's not.
It's like...
and it?
So I got to ask, what did you use the comm relay for?
So this is probably my favorite part of the list, and now I want to do this for all my things in the future, is because direct is such a balanced and fair keyword, we were able to, we directed to the phase two, or actually with fives in there, we directed the fives to the phase two, coordinated phase two. Phase two would then relay it over to the tank to the instead.
Tank.
So the tank, every with turn, LTA. Yes, with LTA. And so every turn, the tank had a aim and an order for free, which was cash money. That was great. There was, I won't jump too far ahead, but just there was a game where I had to make the choice of, do I need to refresh and shoot like range four or move up range three? And because I had an aim, I could make the choice to refresh and still have an aim to rely on. So it was nice.
Yeah.
So,
that's fair.
I get that.
Yeah. So free orders on tanks seems pretty good. Not free.
Free tokens are nice.
I paid for it. But
I mean, it costs you five.
Yeah.
And the guys.
But yeah. And the nice thing too, I mean, the comp stick is a combatant, so you know he still throws dice.
Yeah, you can shoot.
So I have a 5-man phase.
It was 57 points.
But yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. It wasn't free, but it's a 5-man phase too. At the end of the day, so it's not a bad thing.
Back control.
Yeah,
back control is always great.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Great. Back control all weekend was great. But yeah, that was what I brought. Will, what did you bring?
Well, you may think that I would bring what I had played 14 games with in the lead up to Rocky Top.
You would think.
My double ISP, double flamer, fun times, good times. But I blame the terrain crafting madness of being up till midnight a few many nights of like, I could try this list instead. Yeah. Let's submit that. So I played double Jedi shenanigans.
But so Yoda Anakin, right?
Yanni. You played Yanni.
You did what Tim did.
Yes.
Right? No. No.
Oh, so it was Yoda Obi-Wan taking the new Republic hotness paired with your experience with Obi-Wan?
No.
You didn't bring the bros.
I brought the bros.
Murder bros.
Two brothers. It was Anakin Obi-Wan. Yeah. 9 activation Anakin Obi-Wan. We had Anakin with push, throw, endurance, and seize. Obi-Wan with push, barrier, vigilance, tenacity. So he was the murder glider.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they were surrounded by garbage. It was it was 2 naked phase ones and 2 naked phase twos, followed by 2 naked barks, and then an AT-RT with a laser cannon, which just took up space. I brought a pretty hefty bid to 794 because my deck was the stuff of nightmares for players who hate chaos. I had so many players look at me like I was the Joker as I told them about my battle deck. We had danger close, disarray, hemmed in battle lines.
Yes.
Bombing run, hostage, breakthrough, KP.
Yep.
Fortified, supply drop, limbviz, war weary.
Man, when you take the troll hard, you take the troll hard. I love this.
I hate to play against it.
Absolutely you can.
Oh,
that's awesome, actually. Bombing Run is fantastic for that list.
Yep, and especially now that I have a third Bark that I can swap in for that AT-RT, it's going to be even stronger.
So I'm great
on Bombing Run. The other two are slow objectives that I can just murder blender them.
Yeah.
Yep.
They don't want War Weary at all. Your Phase 2s don't care. The only ones who might care is your Phase 1s.
And I don't care about them on most of the objectives. Exactly.
They're sacrificial. So.
Yep.
Oh, wow.
And I brought it as a meme, and it turned out to not be, but we'll get there.
Nice.
Yeah, that's fair.
Then the surprise entry of the weekend was a certain Ben Fowler?
Yes. So we had a miscommunication with one of our participants who didn't get the memo about our schedule change when we went up to 64 players. And so they showed up a little late, and instead of giving them a bye, things were going pretty smooth. So we just grabbed Ben. And Ben, you got to play the first round.
Woo! So Ryan's like, yeah, you got your list on you. I was like, I have all my things here. But I had been parceling units out of my bag for people's like, I need this or I need that. Or people who didn't have a quite full painted army. So they're just borrowing my stuff. So I was like, I think I have most of it. Let's see what we can throw together. And the round had started up. Like, we'd already done pairings. Like, we were already about 2 or 3 minutes into the first round. But this guy had driven, I think, from Atlanta. So, you know, he was a 3.5-hour drive in. He wanted to play. I was like, all right, let's do this thing. So I pulled out my classic double snail list, the snail of the dragon. So It was delightful. You know, it's got all the things that I love to have there. Gary, Larry, 2B2s with the Haas, the Heelbots, the 2B1s with the E5Ss, the B1 with the HQ, the naked B1, and the generic STD with the commanding presence, because I love to give that direct anywhere I want to. So my opponent, like I said, lots of fun. He was also playing CIS. Because he had the ions spiders. He had one spider with just the laser cannon, okay, which was kind of fun. He was playing Kalani, so he gave out all the orders. He had Magnus with the RPSs and all that jazz.
So just CIS good stuff.
CIS good stuff. Now, so we had talked in the last episode about me taking out of my deck Sabotage. Mm-hmm. And I had taken it out. But then Brett had borrowed my payload. So in the mad rush to put the deck back together again, I had to put Sabotage back in. And be damned, we didn't play Sabotage again. The thing I said I didn't particularly want to do. We were playing on an incredibly interesting map. It was a broken apart Millennium Falcon in like a desert scheme.
Ooh.
Will and I were talking about this. I think they may have destroyed an old toy from the 80s.
I think so.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure. I'm almost certain they did.
I had several walkers who like came to the convention to like look at all the vendor booths and stuff and like some of the old toys and collectible sellers, and they're like, you know, that table is worth like would have been worth like $500, and y'all cut it up and painted it, and we're like, yep, sure do, you should go look at this other table that's got a destroyed collectible on it.
It was, yeah. And I thought that, I was like, oh, that's a terrain, lot of money that someone put into this
terrain. Thanks, for Steven, the terrain
thanks,
gods
Sylvia, for bringing that out.
Yep.
So, you know, we're CIS, so we order everything all the time. There's going to be attempt to eye on each other, and that's the thing that happens. But I know with Sabotage, you've got to kill the things that you can kill and get the thumbs on. So I start blowing up. I try to ignore the Magnus where I can. It's just a range issue. He tries to eye on me. I actually make a decision a little poorly. I could have healed an ion off in order to move my snail, but I didn't, so I delayed. So honestly, coming into the final round, we're just trading shots, but it's CIS. Neither of us have lost a full unit yet.
Right.
And then, you know, suddenly you say that, but then suddenly a unit is dead. I've lost my B2s. So if we go to the Sabotage tie, I'm going to lose on kill points. And I see this. So I do a hard dive. My opponent has gotten a little feisty. He wants to go forward and kill. See, he's actually going to go try to grab my Sabotage area so he can win 5-1 or 5-2, something like that. And he decides not to tap one of his back, because he's got a unit that's close enough, so he just hasn't pulled the final trick on the final Sabotage. He's just going to do it on the last round. I drive that snail forward. I blow up the guys who could do it. There's not enough thumbs nearby. And then I take my B2s and I shoot out into the group, and I actually panic the unit that's sort of close enough, and they're going to run off the board on the same turn.
Nice.
And this happens in the last three activations
of
our final round before time gets called. So I managed to snap up that victory real fast. My opponent didn't see it was a thing that was going to happen until it happened. So, and part of that's the misdirect. I'll be real honest. It's playing, not eyeballing the thing you're looking at doing, but, you know, paying attention, making people think you're going to fight on this side of the board. And then I just snuck that in. But it was close, honestly. It was a real, real close thing. And if I had not gotten priority on the last round, I don't know that I'm able to pull that off. Because we tied on our command cards, and the dice got rolled. My opponent rolled the dice. But it came to me first, so let me do the thing to drive home my victory point. So, woo! I'm 1-0 for the tournament.
And probably dropped.
I promptly dropped. So, undefeated, I am. The only undefeated Stabcast player of the weekend.
It's true. Boo. It's true. So close. Boo. For some of us.
So close. So that was Ben's round one. How did the real competitors do? Surely both of you crushed your first
game.
That's
such a nice title, Tim. You give me.
Yeah.
I love that.
Hey,
thank you.
You know,
buddy.
Tim, you start every tournament 0-0, ready to go. You
that's
know?
Right. Sure do. And who am I to buck the trend? So my first opponent was the lovely Wes Wagner, also known as Shadowfax on the Discord. And he played a mighty Iden triple ISF, you know, one of them being Inferno, triple Dubek. And the Dubeks had the T-21 gun on them.
It's a good list.
With Tenacity. It is a very solid list. Very good list. And I love ISF and I love Dubeks. So, like, facing them, even though I know it's going to be rough, I'm like, it's always fun to lose to something you enjoy. So you're like, all right, that's fine. And sure enough, we went back and forth. To be quite honest, this tax strike was fine. Like, it wasn't bad, but it wasn't, like, crushing either. But he just had such a weight of critical that he just was able to get my saber tank off the board. I think round, it was like bottom of round two. I think it was like the last thing that happened, end of round two.
That's gross.
Yeah. And again, it was just weight of critical. I mean, my red saves were fine, I guess. Maybe a little under, but nothing to write home about. The only thing that was in that game that was super crazy dice-wise was I did put that saber tank, put 24 hits. We counted, him and I both. 24 hits into that one of his Dubecks. The Dubeck only suffered 2 wounds.
Oh, gross.
Obviously, it was not 24 all at once, like, but over the course of the slave time, yeah. It was
Can
disgusting.
I buy those red saves?
Yeah.
Use it was them for disgusting. My loot?
Can I buy them for my
Absolutely enemy? Absolutely disgusting, yeah. It was gross. But anyway, so long story short, lost that game. It was a game that happened. Once the saber went down, the chieftain did okay, but he just couldn't keep up, and I just couldn't be in enough places.
I feel like, and you can tell me I'm wrong, Tim, but looking at like your list on paper, if that saber goes down too early, you're really kind of scrambling. I feel like it's an anchor that holds a lot of your list together and lets the other parts really excel.
Yes and no. It depends on the objective. In this case, unfortunately for this one, I can't remember what our objective was. I don't know why it's escaping my brain. I was trying to think about it before, but whatever it was, it mattered enough that I couldn't do it. But it's really just the fact that he had so many. Oh, it was breakthrough. That's right. It was breakthrough, and so he was able to just surge forward and get those dubacks and scoring. And it was, by the time it was all said and done, I think he won 8-3. So it was rough. It was rough.
Look at you getting 3 guys across the field.
Yeah, at some point we honestly just ignored each other and just ran. I was trying to slow him down best I could, and I couldn't slow him down enough, so it's all right. So my plan had the tank live to, you know, like strafe at the end and score at the end, but it's all right. It's all good. But it was a great opponent. He played really, really well. It was a fun game, despite the loss. Will, what did you do? Did you also lose? Did you join me at the bottom of the first round?
Well, I also played against the Empire. I played Dustin from North Alabama, I think Huntsville-ish. He was running a Palp Bosk triple dues, which sounds pretty gnarly when you look at it on a list. But my Chaos deck, he was not prepared for.
Palp Bosk, because I've run Palp Bosk a bunch, like, it can be real gnarly, but also, like, they're both pretty squishy bros, so if they get hit
the three dudes are for. They eat the stuff.
And, that's fair.
And he did a good job of double shooting with Bosk to make sure he could play Not a Story the Jedi Would Tell. But he played it turn 2, which was a bit early, because that meant I just played Obi-Wan cards. Which is an interesting fallback, because normally when you play Anakin, you're like, damn it, the flaw card, now I'm stuck. But it's like, no, I'll just go with the other the other melee beat stick this round, I guess. Like, playing the two of them together had some interesting interactions that we'll talk about.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I believe that.
We ended up on Hostage, War Weary, and Battle Lines. He was solo commander with Palp, so it was... The War Weary was not great for his Naked Storms, because he just had like 3 of them, along with his T21 Endurance Dubacks.
See, that's where it's at. Endurance Dubacks for the win.
Endurance Dues, Bosk with Scopes and all that. Palpatine with Outpush, though. It was a choice.
Interesting. Okay.
I've seen more and more of that, though, because there's good options around.
It was Hate, Barrier, and Burst, I think.
Yep. That's normally
that's utility Palpatine,
where
you're just going to kind of hang back and let Bosk do his thing. And
yeah, he hid back and blocked a few hits and then bursted out to do Now You Will Die, and it worked. But first, he charged in his Dubacks, and turn 1, Obi-Wan got to charge 1, did half damage. Turn 2 into a Hello There with Anakin Seize.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
So we're going to explain this now. with Anakin having Seize on Hello There, Obi-Wan can take a standby token as one of his free green tokens, and then you activate Anakin on the one pip, and Anakin uses Force Push to move whatever Obi-Wan's engaged with or is nearby, then Obi-Wan uses the standby to charge them when it's Anakin's turn.
Right. Okay. Okay. Yep. That's gross. So, thank you.
So Obi-Wan's in with this half-dead dewback. Anakin pulls it out of the melee. Obi-Wan uses that to charge another full health dewback with his like 3 aim dodge standby tokens.
Yeah.
Obi-Wan kills that dewback during Anakin's activation. Okay. Then we go back to Anakin's second action, which is a saber throw to kill the dewback that was in melee with Obi-Wan before.
Oh. See, I was like, do you get really trolly and take another standby on Anakin that Obi-Wan can then spend?
Not quite. Just
go back and forth. Yeah.
Not quite. I could have, but I was standing on top of a rock in range 3.
Yeah, stuff, yeah, you're going to lose that standby.
Yeah, I just decided to kill another activation. And that kind of started the snowball that just kept rolling. My barks were flying around the map, found Bossk in his hidey hole, and did 6 damage to him. Because he is a squishy lizard.
Yes.
Then he did his burst of speed, Now You Will Die, to murder Obi-Wan, murderized him. But it took all of it to do that, and I did a couple on the reflect, so he didn't get all his attacks.
Right.
And then a naked phase 2 stood up and killed Palpatine.
Yay!
They were just like, oh, wow, that's range 3.
Phase 2's are the future.
In the open.
That's bang. Right. Yeah. Naked phase 2's are the future.
They did. They did. It was silliness. It was fun. But he ended the game with 2 stormtroopers on the table.
No.
Yeah. And my hostage scored in my deployment for a 2-0 win. You know, he said he's still learning some things, but was excited to play and asked me for some tips. And was like, well, he did a lot of like splitting around his shots. And he's like, I'll shoot that bark. I'll shoot that AT-RT. I'll shoot that
unit. Right, right.
And he remarked that when I shot, it was very like, I shoot that thing, I shoot it again, and I shoot it again. It's like, no, yeah. You really got to burn stuff down. And
burn activations off, yep.
Yeah, so it was a good time, and he's a great player, and checked on him during the day.
Just checking in. Hey, buddy.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, you run into people, you're like, oh, how you doing? You know?
That's fair. That's fair.
That kind of thing. No, but it ended 1-0, which was halfway to my goal of 2-3. So already doing great.
To be fair, that was also my goal, I think. I wanted to go positive.
I got my most interesting rules call during round 1.
Oh, did you?
From Michael Henry, which was he's running double bus, and if you put rebel vets in a bus, and the other bus is next to the first bus,
oh,
can
no.
you use detachment to put the Mark II into the second bus?
Ooh, that is an interesting question. And no. What is your rule on?
Maybe.
So my initial reading was no, because you'd have to deploy the regular Mark II as a normal unit, because the vets physically aren't on the table. There's no legal speed one. But after doing some digging in the rules form and for some like adjacent ways the rules read, like some of the way other mechanics that are similar to it came out, and posting in one of the Legion Discord judge groups, we all kind of shrugged and said we think so. So we in either case he was allowed to do it, because if he couldn't do it, that meant he couldn't
deploy them at all.
He would deploy them just as a normal unit, and he could normally deploy them into the bus.
Right.
Mm.
That's kind of what I was thinking anyway. I was like, I don't know why it matters, because you could just go into the bus. But yeah, I get it.
But you do, since you are allowed to make a legal speed one move outside of the bus, you just put a regular trooper mini adjacent to the bus, measure with the speed one move, and then if that would put it next to the other bus, he can get inside. It was weird.
That's weird.
We let him do it either way. I'm going to put a rules question up on the forum this week and get official ruling.
What
for
a bizarre
it,
question.
My understanding is it works.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, LJ. Fun. That's a weird one.
Yeah,
we're sorry.
People hate on the forum sometimes, but I love them for that exact reason of like, this should never really be in a rule book, but this probably should be addressed somewhere. Like, you don't need to put that in writing other than on a forum.
Yeah.
So that was fun. Thanks, Michael Henry. Appreciate you.
Yeah. Seriously. That's, man. I mean, I had a fun time in my round 1 game, but I kind of wish I'd been there to shadow that decision-making process. Yes. So, because in round 2, since I'm no longer playing, I am now just being a rules robot. I'm just walking around answering questions. I'm being an assistant to the TO.
Yeah.
And you know, I'd make some decisions. I'd go grab my book, because both Ryan and I have printed copies of the RRG.
Got to.
Just to be safe.
If you're running a big event, you got to.
Yeah, it's better to look it up. It's something you can hand to a player and say, listen, it's right here. It's in the book. You can kind of point to it much easier than on a computer.
Subsection and, D.
Yep. Exactly.
Well,
and we're also using our computers to broadcast on the television, yeah. like the time and the ranking, yeah. or the, you know, the listings for table setups.
Which was nice. People really appreciated that with some of the internet yeah. issues we had.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it was nice. So the building is it's an older style building. I probably built what the 40s.
Yeah. It looks like a prison. We're not going to lie.
It's all concrete and rebar.
Yep.
And see, it looked like a prison because the windows they had built in the place in the 40s before air conditioning
yes.
are all kind of covered up, so you don't have the sunlight, the heat, all the things mm-hmm. that normally come in and out. Like they used to be able to open these windows.
Yeah, but
50 years ago,
they're just right, single yeah. pane plate glass, so they're not. It's yeah. like yeah, we need exactly. to cover those up because they just yeah. let the heat right in.
Exactly. So it does look on the inside like a concrete bare floor, but it's because it's very, you know, very flexible. You can do a lot with it.
Yeah.
But and also no internet because of that.
So it, we I was going to say, it also Wi-Fi. Blocks all cell signals. You could walk. Yep. I actually did it one time. I walked get outside. Okay signal. Yeah. I walked from the mm-hmm. outside and I walked in and I saw my bars go boop, 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 boop down.
Yep.
Like all the way down. Okay.
But yeah, so I did a lot of that in rounds, you know, 2 through 5. Just walk around with a book, answering some questions. Or, hey, Ryan, I've got this thing. Here's my judgment. Ryan was sitting behind me, critique my judging styles. You know, those kind of pieces. But it was good. I had a lot of fun with those pieces. But that starts round the 2. Information gets into the computer. Tables are set. Tim, where do you go? What do you play?
I go to the desert table, which is actually, I really enjoy this one. It was, I think, probably my highest marks as far as table rankings go, because it was very thematic, very balanced. It was like a Tatooine, downtown Tatooine map. How about that?
Downtown Tatooine. Yes,
lots of buildings, but not too many. It was great. But I played Garrett Beck, and he played a Luke Airspeeder list, OP Luke Airspeeder.
I really like how his speeder was painted.
Based. Yes.
It had like
yes.
little trees yes. and stuff
oh,
on it.
Oh, yeah, really that nice. Army, that was beautiful.
Yeah, yeah his basing, yeah, cool. I told him, I was like, your army is beautiful, but not only that, your basing is like next level beautiful. Yeah,
it yeah. was gorgeous. Yeah, it really was.
We got to Slingin', and we got to KP. And with that map, KP was in such a place where, well, major offensive, I should say. There was this little, like, barricade, little like, rundown piece of boxes sewn together by mud. And it was just outside my deployment. So that was my KP. And then the middle KP was a TIE fighter that was just about a tank's base away. It was beyond range 1 for all the rules. But it's... So basically, all that equates to is my tank first activation moved, and then I never moved again, other than a couple pivots to get better shots, because he just was touching the KP. So I was automatically scoring. So it was a great time. And because that tank base is huge. It's another other great thing about that saber. Is really big. Yeah. I played multiple games with KP because of the tank base. And so it just was able to sit there and just shoot down these firing lanes, which was really nice. His airspeeder came in a little bit too quick, and so I was able to get some early shots on that from the tank and then also just from everything else to where that was kind of the only thing I could shoot. So I said, okay, I'll just shoot it. And hey, with enough dice, eventually you get enough crits, and it died. Like nothing crazy happened. Wow. It just was sheer weight of numbers. It just happened.
Yeah.
So that went down, I think it was either bottom of 1 or top of 2. And then he played Son of Skywalker turn 2 because Luke had crept up behind the buildings, jumping all around, doing his jump shenanigans. And jump he played Son of Skywalker yeah. and got into melee, and he killed. He sent a Skywalker when he probably shouldn't have. He went in, attacked 5 squad, killed everyone but 5s on his first swing. And then 5s was alive. And then he attacked again, and I kind of think he shouldn't have done that, because then what happened was, okay, very sad, 5s died, but now you're in front of everyone in the army.
Yep.
Yeah. And so the tank, which had already pivoted to shoot the airspeeder or something like that, was also able to get him in arc and everything. And so it was just like, well, hello. And we just, again, we just lit him up.
You really want to be able to force push something into another melee there.
Yeah, and the Wookiee Chieftain actually didn't go into melee. I just aimed and shot him and then fire supported because a surge hit. So we just did that. And I mean, he had a couple dodges and I took, or one dodge. So, I mean, we took 2 back as far as wounds go, but we killed him. So that was, That was pretty devastating to lose both those heavy pieces pretty early on for him. So then it was just a matter of holding on to my two KPs, and I was able to do so. I made one unit panic at one point, but then it came back. So yeah, long story short, I was able to hold on to those KPs with that tank base. It was super clutch. Yeah,
loot going down early and the speeder going down early are your two big answers to your tank.
Yeah.
I think it was one turn too aggro with Luke, maybe.
Sure.
And then also, again, shouldn't have killed the fives.
And that's a common mistake. That's mistakes I've made when I was learning to play Luke. It's like you're paying 200 points. You want him to swing as early and as often as possible. But a lot of times you got to play real patient for two turns and then just let Luke control the battlefield at the end of turn three.
Yeah.
Once some stuff, he can get it tangled up with stuff that's already been activated. Mm-hmm. And then kill them, but not all of them. And then disengage, let your shitty rebel troopers pick off unit leaders. And go into the next big thing.
Yeah, but it was a good game. Still close because I mean he still had a lot of units that could like run in and touch the point. Mm-hmm. So I still had to make sure I was killing things. So it wasn't like I was just done. So but we played it out, and I should say game one and two, I believe, both went to round six. So there you go.
That's good.
And actually, this game was so quick. We got done and we looked up at the clock like, oh, well. I guess we get a second lunch because we had an hour left.
Yeah, I was about to say. Yeah, you guys had like 90 minutes left. Yeah, y'all had a long time.
Yeah, I guess we're done. So I guess we'll just have lunch again. Okay. Bye.
So we haven't really talked about the tables of this piece.
Yeah.
Right.
In part because when you're putting on 64, you got to have 32 tables. We were very worried about how we were going to make that work. And, you know, we talked previously how we had Jeremy Appleton loaned us some tables, how the process of getting all that stuff back. Will and I have been busting some behinds to get more tables and put some things out there. So Tim is playing in what I called the Norman Rockwell Mos Eisley. And that came from Dan Wolf years ago that we kind of maintained and updated and, you know, cleaned up. It's a fantastic table, but I mention it because of this. It is apparently the kryptonite of one.
I was wondering if you were going to mention this because I was going to if you didn't.
So apparently, Michael Henry has never won on this table, and all the because we've had this table for a very long time.
We've
been floating
around.
It's been it gets played in Atlanta, got played at New Orleans, and he apparently has never won on this table. So now that I know this, we'll just happen to make sure it happens every time. it's got a dice tower built into the terrain, so it's got a nice little courtyard, but you can also roll dice in the tower. It comes out. I can roll lots of crits when I use that tower. It's amazing. Kind of like Shogun, sometimes Michael Henry would just lose dice in the tower. It's really nice for me. So apparently it is his kryptonite, and we know this.
Yeah, and kind of on that note, a huge thank you to everybody. We had a terrain competition. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But to everyone that did bring out tables.
Were fantastic.
Yeah, we had tables from Pennsylvania, from Florida, from Georgia, from North Carolina.
Chicago, too, right?
Everybody really... Yeah, Chicago. We had more tables than we needed. We had about four or five empty tables every round because we set up 29.
Yeah.
And we still had, I think, three in boxes on reserve, ready to go to make sure if we did hit that 32, we had everything we needed. A lot of people who I didn't think were coming showed up. And it was awesome. It was absolutely awesome.
Yeah.
So big thank you to everyone who hauled stuff down.
And on that note, like I said, we had 64 tickets sold. We'd planned on 64. And we hope everyone is healthy and safe out there because we've had a lot of sickness in the last week and a half or so.
Yeah. It was like everyone dropped because of sickness, honestly. It was everyone was like planning to go.
My kids are sick. My wife is sick. I'm sick. You know, this is the thing. Mm-hmm. So the drops I don't think were, I just don't want to go.
No, very much stuff came up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, it was a good time.
And if you're sick, we appreciate you not coming and getting all of us sick.
True.
And we hope
especially in our stone prison that we were in. There's not the most air circulation going on, so thank you.
Hey, we had every table you could walk all the way around. We did our best to combine.
There was good space. There was good space. Yes, for sure.
Yeah.
So, speaking of great tables, in fact, this became the number one table of the entire event.
What a segue.
Will, you got to play on Jim Butler's Light Jungle Temple table. People love this table.
I played
also
on it.
Known as the Mall in a Tank table.
Yes.
There was the central feature was a big Sith temple with a back-to-tank featuring a Darth Maul, I believe, floating.
Yes.
And apart from how we needed to modify the table during this game, it was a very nice table. We had to scoot that terrain feature a little bit because the top of the tank was the direct center, and we played hostage, which would have been an issue.
Hold on. Also, you
Ryan came over and just scooted it.
Yes, you screwed it.
Yeah, I was like, my intention was to make sure this was slightly off center, and then I guess
he played around. And then Tim's about to say that he didn't even realize that
the tank could get moved. You can just move Maul.
Like, we thought tank, it was glued to the it's piece not glued of terrain. Tim was just like, you know, you can move it, and he just picked up the Maul piece and scooted it. And was like, oh.
Huh. I mean, that works too, but it's fine. Half dozen of the other, I guess.
Yep. But in this game, I played Sean from Atlanta, my nemesis.
Ooh. Dun, dun, dun.
We'll hold judgment. We will not declare him any of the podcast until you tell us
my first
story.
Of three Republic mirrors of this tournament. There were only nine of us.
I just pressed the button, man. I just pressed the button.
It ended up being okay because I needed to crush them to try to get best Republic, so it's fine. But he was playing an Anakin Padme Overwatch party with shooty Wookiees with, Overwatch and scopes, and then he had a bunch of Z6 troopers for fire supporting those guys, and it was all a nightmare.
But so many Wookiees, like, it's it was so just many a field of fur.
I think my only benefit was that I outbid him, so I had my deck, which meant we got to play hostage. So I had some chance because I didn't have to engage him at all.
yeah, that's true.
That terrain feature meant that the hostages were even closer to me than they probably would have been. So turn two, I rolled up and dove over a terrain feature to get Obi-Wan into his hostage, force pulled it back behind Obi-Wan, then activated Anakin, force pulled it into him, meleeed them so they were dead. So that my hostage was near my deployment zone and his was about a speed two away from my deployment zone unclaimed on turn two.
Mm.
The only issue is it was only turn two.
You do have to play the rest of the game.
And then and I are pretty snappy, quick players. So, you know, we played a sweaty turn, a 6-round game, and we still had probably 45 minutes left on the timer by the end of it. But it was, we're both in it, like sweating our, you know, having a sweaty, close, competitive match. But it wasn't going to time. And I'm not somebody that's like, well, I think I'm going to move this unit. Right. Like, no. And it went especially quick because when you're staring at all this standby crap and you have a bunch of naked core troopers, just don't do anything. Just don't let them have it. I don't think I'd ever passed an activation before in Legion. You know, normally you're like, oh, I'll just aim, shoot, I'll move, whatever.
Dodge, standby. Yeah. Just whatever.
I passed on activations 7 times in this match.
That is so crazy to think that is the best play.
Because
and it was
frozen.
Your best play.
Just
well, because they're just like phase twos in heavy cover at range two of a bunch of Wookiees, and it's like, you're going to shoot, you're going to use, whatever I do, you're going to use it to shoot at Anakin or shoot at Obi-Wan or shoot at the hostage carrier.
Yep.
So, no.
No.
Nothing. Back to you.
And I was
and
say,
each time he would kind of glare at me like, okay. I'm like, yeah, no, screw you. I'm not letting you have this.
I got to praise you for it because it is the right play. It is not the play that feels good.
It
is not the play that feels like you would want to do. And
I knew what I needed
would have
to
just
do.
Moved. Yeah, and they would have gotten shot to pieces. They would have turbo lost in your
and
world.
That's like that's what we talked about later. It's like if I had just like dodge shot you, it's like I would have lost turn three because he gets so many extra shots with sharpshooter one piercing Wookiees and mm-hmm. No.
It's the Jurassic Park gambit where if you don't move they can't see you,
right? Yes. It's true. They can only sense
absolutely.
Movement. but I'm just running with a phase two that's carrying a hostage and he gets it down to a unit leader, but I save out one shot and just book it. He's chasing them down. Obi-Wan grabs the other hostage and stands in this area terrain and just says, I'm going to be a problem now. And made
and
his Anakin come deal with it. So he's chasing down this phase two. I grab a squad of Wookiees that are about to shoot him with one of my phase ones, which he said he didn't expect. It's like, no, I had to melee you because we were going into six. So I needed to nullify that last activation for them.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of tense, sweaty measuring and looking at things and planning it out. And we're both grimacing at each other like, oh, God. But also like, damn, man, this is a good game. That kind of stuff. Like, we're both enjoying it. but it comes down to it. He kills my original hostage carrier with a Wookiee shot, with a move shoot, gets that pierce with a red white.
Yep.
Gets him. So now all that's left is Obi-Wan holding a hostage with a few wounds left, but he still has like three activations. So he shoots him with a phase one, gets a wound in, two left on Obi-Wan. He has the choice of meleeing me with Anakin or saber throwing me. And I think if he meleeed me, he would have lost. But he saber throwed. And he actually did the two wounds to kill him there. But I told him that if he hadn't, you know, he still had another shot on me. So he probably would have had it anyways. But if he'd meleeed me and whiffed it hard enough, or I saved it out, then I would have won because then he can't shoot me.
He couldn't shoot you.
Right.
Yeah. So he made the right call. And he did get the Obi-Wan. So it was 0-0. And he had me by a bunch on kill points. Like he had. Right. Yeah. There were a couple squat. There were like. He had killed Anakin earlier after the hostage ran back because Anakin was trying to do a delay and just got shot to death. Like I had a few clone squads on the table, I think was all. So it was.
We got to talk about.
It was
the non-Obi-Wan hostage. If you look at your map, and on the far right-hand side, 2 inches from the right and 2 inches up from the bottom is where that hostage was.
Right. Yeah,
there was nowhere else to run.
They were deep.
Yeah, they were
deep in there.
We were on advanced positions. So basically, it ran to the corner, like, on the bottom right of my table edge. Like, it was in that corner.
Because I asked you, was his model dead? You're like, no, that's the hostage. I was like, what the?
Yeah. Like, no, it made it there. That phase two double moved every turn. And I would activate them first because he would have to standby stack. So I'd be like, I'm putting an order on that phase two, and it is running twice for GTFO its action. Phase two.
Goodbye.
But he did get me, but I made sure it was a 0-0 win for him, which haunted him for the rest of the tournament, because Sean and I ended up in a very tense competition for best Republic player, which we will follow up on as we go.
So I'll be honest, I mean, it was a sweaty game. It was a great game to watch. Like, I really enjoyed watching that game. But he likes a great play on both sides. I cannot name him enemy of the Stabcast at this time. I cannot do so.
I am not requesting enemy of the Stabcast.
He's just a nemesis.
He's the enemy of Will.
Yes, it's just a personal nemesis. It's a personal vendetta. We just stay out of it as a corporation. You know, it's fine.
Yes. The views of this individual do not reflect the views of this organization, the Stabcast.
The Stabcast lawyer will not be devoted to litigation against him, is what we're saying.
Who?
Exactly.
Daisy?
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah, Daisy.
Daisy
yeah,
in Daisy. A suit.
Daisy's the,
yeah, Daisy the in a suit.
And a Daisy in a tie. Yes.
So, Tim, round three comes around.
Yes.
You are on table seven, another Jim Butler special.
Yes.
This is a grassy jungle terrain.
I really
enjoy
that. So,
Tim, you also own this. You also own the same temple setup. Who makes that temple?
Sorry. It's Imperial Terrain.
That Imperial Terrain temple set is well-loved by tons of people.
Yes, it is. I think it was on five or seven of our tables.
Yes.
It was on a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah.
A lot of people use it, but it's also always highly voted.
Yeah, right?
It just looks so good. And it has that nice line of sight blocking, but also see through for some places.
Yes.
The walls, the circle, like it's just well designed. Well, so I got to give it a shout out to those people.
That's why I think is because it's got the nice curve to it. It's all about that nice curve. And then it's so you can get around it if you need to. You can have it behind it. Again, like the stairs are like a barricade, so you have heavy cover. You get on top. Now, the only thing I do, and we've mentioned this before, but I'll say it again since this wasn't the map I was on, is I always mention this to my opponents, and I think all weekend long, everyone agreed to it. And I'm never a big stickler on this, but I want everything to be playable. And so terrain-wise, especially big, important pieces like that. So the problem with it is sometimes you get up there, and you can't get back down without going backwards. And like that, Legion's not normally a game where you go backwards, traditionally. So what we tend to do is we'll talk about it. There's a shield generator. There's some stack crates that are literally attached to the curve pieces. And so I just say treat them as if they're difficult to get up and down. So rather than saying, because it is just tall enough that normally you would have to clamber up. So saying instead of clamber, go to this, treat it almost like stairs, but like difficult stairs to get up there. So it's not free, but also you're not stuck. So you can't do it.
Right.
And so far we've played it that way 9 times out of 10, and it almost always works out for the better. So that's always just fun to note. For anyone who has those pieces or are looking at them, there you go.
yeah. They're fantastic.
They are. They are. And actually, yeah, I got to play
this. Play and what you play.
So I got to play on this map. And then actually, I will say, I got to play on that map that Will was just talking about, too. That was my first round. So,
yep.
And they're next to each other.
My first round was on the one we're talking about now.
That's funny. That's funny.
That is funny.
We literally just swapped around from the two tables, six and seven. Yeah.
And the two jungle one, the two jungle temples next to each other. So I got him confused all the time because I'm like, I played on that jungle. Oh, that
that's
the other jungle.
That's why I started saying
it was a little bit more grassy, more grassy plains, kind of. Yeah, well, with the occasional tree.
One of them had Maul. That was how I determined.
Yes, that's very fair. Very fair. But anyway, I played Josh Dean, and he had a really cool eight act, which makes me nervous just saying it. But eight act, Yoda, Chewie, triple Wookiee, melee Wookiees with bowcasters. And then three phase one list. So that was it.
Okay.
That was what's in there. And whoo. So we played Sab on Major. And I made a mistake. And I didn't realize it. And I actually did think about when I was doing it. And I thought, this is either going to help me or hurt me. It hurt me. Spoiler alert. It hurt me. But I put it up on top of basically a temple piece, for lack of a better term, right? Had a staircase on one side. Knowing his Wookiees had scale. Now, that said, I thought I would be able to get up there before he could or something like that, or he wouldn't go that way. He pushed on that side more than I thought he would, because obviously you put your objectives down first and then your units. So like I put it there not realizing how much he was going to push that corner. Had I realized that, this game literally came down to, had I just moved my first evaporator to the left, probably like an inch, I then, by result of that, could have moved this one down off the platform onto the ground, and I probably would have won everything. So this was a game of a 1-inch difference, more or less. So we had all kinds of shots back and forth. I got an early shot with the tank onto Chewie, which was great. Got a couple wins on Chewie early on. His core were in the backfield, scoring his points. We played, I'm sorry, not Major. That's right. We treated it like Major. It was hemmed in, but I was red. So I just played in one corner, and I just completely ignored it because I'm clones.
Like, y'all had entire half the map y'all didn't use.
Yeah, so. I'm clones, so I'm going to bunch up. He's going to also kind of bunch up a little bit with his core. I could have technically thrown the tank over there, but that would have thrown everything off. But anyway, so we treated it like Major, and so I played in that corner. And Yoda came in on the back of Chewie, running up. He had some, his Wookiees, my goodness, between Scout and Yoda, they were turn one, almost on my VAP. And so then after they moved on their own movement and with scale, they were on the VAP like turn one, or maybe just underneath it. And then turn two, they jumped up. So yeah, so they were already there before I could get there. And that was really what cost me the game, because then he was able to tap my VAP before I could. And so that's just, I was playing on the back foot the whole time, objective-wise. Kill points-wise, it was going great. I got some good shots into Yoda, again, got some good into Chewie. Yoda blocked a couple, but then Yoda finally got stuck out in the open where he spent all his dodges, and I was like, ha-ha, got him. And so we just offloaded into Yoda. And unfortunately, I realized too late, I was trying to math it out, trying to figure out, okay, how am I going to do this, how am I going to do that? I was probably one turn. I won't say one action because I needed multiple units to do it. Probably like one turn shy of a victory because of him tapping my VAP first. It put me on such a disadvantage because he was able to double tap it. So I had to untap to even it. So I could have gotten to even it, but I wouldn't have had enough victory points. So then I realized, hey, I should play for a table. I don't think in my life I've ever played for a table of an opponent. I think I've done it maybe like once or twice, but it's not normally what I play for. And unfortunately, had I realized that a turn prior, I think I could have done it. But I didn't know that was what the plan had to be until it was too late. So it was just, again, most of that game could be summed up. I was playing on the back foot objective-wise and just trying to figure out how do I make up for it, which is crazy against 8-axe. But I mean, I only have 9-axe myself, so that wasn't a huge differential there. But long story short, after a lot of killing and a lot of dying, he had one phase one trooper model left. That's it.
Ooh.
That was the only thing left on his side of the board. One phase one trooper leader. I couldn't kill him. I threw my last shot, Wookiee shot, pierced one, he blocked the other one, and that was it. That was the game. So he won with one model left, and I still had most of my army left, and that was enough.
So when you brought me this sheet of paper,
yes,
when you brought me the tournament match slip, yes. I was like, okay, typing it in, type it. All right, 4-2, cool. I looked at the points destroyed, and it was you had destroyed 742 points,
yes,
but had lost, and your opponent had only destroyed 237.
Yes,
I was like, what happened?
Yes.
And then you said, come here, and you pointed. He lived.
That's it. The boy who lived. Come to win.
I know, Ben, one of your favorite parts of the entire weekend was just the like moments of you going, hold on a minute, and walking over somewhere to be like, what have you people done?
A lot of that is, this makes no sense. Yeah.
What have you done?
It was super frustrating to lose that way, but again, that's so close, and it's so almost silly. Like to have just because that's, you know, that's not even a whole die roll. That's one die roll.
Yes,
not like
one
not,
block
not a pool,
that got that
just
it
one
happened.
Roll. Yeah. And again, like my dice were fine. His were fine. It wasn't like a crazy math thing. It was just
how
it is how it goes. So frustrating, but also like I played it. And again, I realized my mistake. You could say it all came down to one die roll, but in reality, it comes down to turn zero. I screwed up, and then it then boiled down to one roll.
Once again, I'm saying sabotage evaporators. I'm taking back out of my deck. I don't.
it was a good thing for me to do. I just put him in the wrong spot.
Right.
That's all.
Okay.
I get that. I get that.
Wookiees, man. Wookiees.
So
Wookiees
speaking
are
of y'all flipping tables, I will. You went to go play on the Norman Rockwell Mos Eisley table.
I did go down there. Yeah.
I did not realize as you said it. I'm looking through the TTO and I'm like, oh yeah, y'all really
did. Yeah, they just
kind of
bounced around. Yeah,
we did. I played Sam Collins from Florida, who one of the Tampa crew that came up. I was wearing a UT polo, and I asked if he was still brave enough to wear that down in Florida. He said yes. I'm like, okay. I said his wife is from up here, so he convinced him to be a UT fan. I'm like, okay, more power to you.
Good for him. So he likes pain.
He does like pain.
He enjoys pain.
And he played Yoda Lat with lots of phase ones.
Oh, wow.
It was like a rocket, some Z6s, and then I think he had a naked bark as well. I think it was 9, yeah. And there's a clone commander in there, obviously. So it was like a Yoda gun line thing while Yoda's in a bus, flying bus. it was interesting.
I'm here for it.
I didn't think about how Luminous Being works while he's in the lat, because there's no line of sight. So that's fun and cool.
Yep, that's the thing that works.
But again, my battle deck of chaos threw him off his game. He was probably the most vocal person about what my battle deck did to his spirit. Like, he's just like, I laid out my cards, and he looked at each one, and his just more horror with each card he read. He's like,
this is where I realized what your deck was during this tournament. Like, oh,
well, because he's making a bit of a scene about it, and Ben walked over because again he's like, "What's happening here?" And like, and not a scene, but just going like, "Oh my god, oh god."
I could hear the talk to himself, the mental horror, the emotional damage, as the meme goes, was pretty stiff on the first turn zero.
So this poor man ends up on danger close hostage Limviz with me.
Yeah, baby.
And it is so weird. Danger close hostage is so strange because we started our hostages and, you know, you think of the direction you're supposed to move your hostage and then go, wait a minute, that's the wrong way on danger close.
Yep. Yes, it is. It is absolutely the wrong way.
We joked about flipping our cards to the other sides of the table, and we probably should have for all the times we were walking around the table together. Like,
if I'm playing danger close, I move to the other side of the table.
We should have. Like, he and I did this practice dance of like moving around. Like, I would match him as he moved around the table so that
y'all just circle each other.
Like, I don't want to be like in somebody's business while they're moving or whatever. So I give them space, but kind of like my synchronized movement stuff kicks in from like marching bands. I'm just like, oh, I'll just match him as he comes around. Yep. And
it looked like the knife fight from West Side Story.
Yeah, it was like this pirouette, like circling each other thing. And he's just like,
that's the part of the tournament that we'll start making random tuba noises.
Yeah. and we ended up on hostage, like I said. And he did some Yoda shenanigans to get his hostage clear pretty quick because he knew what I could do with force push mm-hmm. and all the shenanigans.
Double force push.
And so I just went full murder blender saying I would win on kill points. Yoda came out the lat turn one to make sure that happened. And then I double moved Anakin, force pushed Yoda behind him. And that meant Obi-Wan could charge him turn one, honestly. It was it was crazy. And mm-hmm. then turn two, Anakin played his two pip and jumped in. And it was just a beat fest from there. Just whacking on this poor little green man. I did the standby shenanigans to move Yoda, but stay in engagement with both of us. So Obi got a free whack, and then Anakin killed him. It was bad from there. Like, there was a whole clone ball just ready for murdering.
So for those of you following along at home, how many games in your first three did people let you play hostage with double force push?
Three.
That seems like a...
That seems rough.
Wrong.
Yeah. I, you know, correlation doesn't equal causation, but I think this is an exception to that.
So one of them, I was red player and was able to force it to happen. The other two, it was... Yeah. He thought that he could Yoda hard enough to get his hostage clear, which he did.
Which I get. I completely understand that. Mm-hmm. I mean,
But then I just decided to kill his entire army other than the hostage. So
right.
That was where it went downhill, was danger close, meaning he was so close. He said that was where he had a lapse in judgment there, because I think different deployment, maybe he does get clear enough and I have to move through enough shooting that maybe he does take a Jedi out or something. But that one was no bueno for that one. So we had this cinematic moment of the two Jedi and Yoda locked in combat, took photos. It was a great time. Like I said, ended up 2-2 hostage with a pretty close to a tabling, though. He had his hostage group and a lat left on the table, I think, was all.
Yeah.
And he had killed my barks. Like, it was bad, folks. Yeah. It was pretty bad. And later that night, we were hanging out with some other Tampa folk, and I said, oh, I played Sam round three, and they went, oh, that was you. So I was a bit cruel to this poor gentleman. He was a good guy, had a good game.
He's a very nice guy. Yeah. I had some great conversations with all weekend.
Yeah. This is the rise of Darth Heim.
I said I was so forces of evil.
Speaking of those cinematic moments, be sure to check us out on the Instagram. I did take a photo of this in the middle of it happening, posted it to the Instagram at STABcast. We post a lot of table photos. You can check us out on our Facebooks as well, because a lot of our photos, we had a photographer come in, Wally, a local, came in, did some great paint jobs for us, but also took some photos, helped us with some judging of some paint competitions and some table competitions. Great guy, but he posted a ton of stuff to our Facebook thing. So check us out on Instagram, our socials, STABcast.
Be sure to also check us out on the other social medias, Facebook, Twitter. And give us a rating on your listening platform. Helps our visibility. We appreciate that. We're available wherever the finer podcasts are streamed at STABcast.
You can also find us on the Discord, the Legion Discord. You can just at us and at STABcast, whatever our name is. I tend to float around the general channel sometimes. I've been around a little bit more. Works quieted down a little bit.
You mean
and so
Ewok
I'm not...
General? The new...
Yes, Ewok General, correct. I'm not saying that when work quiets down, I spend more time on Discord, just that sometimes they both happen at the same time. That's all. That's all we're saying. But we're on there.
Or you can send us an email at swstabcast@gmail.com. We tend to look at everything, and probably about 85% of it makes it onto the show. Or if you want to support our endeavors, you can either A, come to our tournaments, or B, go to teespring.com/stores/stabcast and buy some cool Stabcast merch like hoodies and fanny packs and t-shirts and stuff. Help keep our servers humming.
So round three ends. It's about 6:30 because of our timing. The venue was going to shut down hard at 10. We didn't think we'd get that fourth game in that night.
Fourth game in, yeah.
It just didn't think.
Plus, this is a casual event. There's no Woes invite on the line.
There's nothing. Yeah, it's perfectly fine. So we decided to do dinner at Schultzbrau.
Yeah. local beer garden, beer castle, and these are always like my favorite parts of these events. Whether it's Gen Con and back alley pizza, or you know, German beer garden in Vegas, and then German beer garden. I'm sensing a trend. in Tennessee. Like these are my favorite bits of just getting out afterwards, drinking some beer, eating some good food, and chit chatting with everybody that you've only met, you know, briefly in passing or maybe just played a game with. We probably had what, maybe close to 20 people come out and join us.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Oh yeah, easily. Yeah.
Yes. And it was a good time. Beautiful weather and outside area. And,
temperature was nice and cool. Like it was.
Yeah.
Oh, it was
fantastic. And I was definitely worried about being outside in early summer, but it turned out wonderful.
See, as nerds, we should always worry about being outside.
No, we I don't do.
Belong. This is very true. Yes. I had safe. Not really had a lunch. You know, you get busy. You're doing the processing of the things. You're setting stuff
you're
up.
Being
you know,
Ryan's
the things.
Slave.
Yeah, and being Ryan's slave. So yeah. I had a pocket pretzel that I had bought at some point. So I had been chewing on this pretzel.
I would just watch Ben pull a piece of pretzel out of his pocket. And I was like, what the hell is going on?
So, of course, since I had a pretzel for lunch, I had to go have some schnitzel and dunkel for dinner.
Yeah.
And it was
just
so,
beer.
So
you just
dinner.
Really wanted. I was gonna say you just wanted to just kill your stomach with yeast and bread, didn't you?
Yes, that's really what happened. You know, fried pork loin. God. It was quite delightful. This is the thing I always love when we go to these events. It's the after Legion community. It's the dinner and it's the conversations. And I got to shout out Phil and Brandon, Will and Brett. We had a great convo while I was super hungry and eating my pork loin, drinking my beer. Like, it's fantastic. And then later I went out to sit with JJ and Tim and Chris Vandergriff and had a lovely cigar and conversation bit. It was a fantastic evening. The decent band that was playing with it.
Yes.
Not quite too loud after the sun set down. So
yeah, no, you know. The concern is always when they have their amps tuned up too hard and it's just like, what? Yep. But no, they were a good balance of just...
We joked a couple times where the band was stopping me like, so who wants to meet the band? And no one's here to meet the band. But other than that, they were great. Yeah, they were in the background.
It's not Spinal Tap, guys. Let's turn that down to a good solid 7, right? Yeah. Just a 7 will be fine.
I shouldn't notice you're there. Yeah.
But no, fantastic fun evening. Like I said, Michael Henry was out with us. Even Brett joined the conversation. You know, sometimes it can be a little hermity in large crowds, but good jokes were made, lots of fun.
Yeah.
Talk about our games, but also talk about other things. What do we want to see? What do we think is going to happen? Talking about the news of the day. How good is Doctor Strange? You know, those kind of things.
how good was Obi-Wan? That's the real question.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And part of it is because Obi-Wan released on Friday.
I still haven't watched
this
yet.
This is Saturday night. Some of us
hadn't
gotten there yet.
This.
You had enough time. There's only 2 episodes up. You have enough time to watch that.
I
got up early Friday morning.
Night.
I got episode 1. I did not get episode 2, so I've still yet to do it as of this recording. When we close out this recording, I'm going to go watch
the ending of 2.
And then Stranger
chills.
Things.
Ending of 2 will give you chills. So we'll say.
So anyhow, fantastic dinner, fantastic evening time, and then it was Sunday morning, round the 4.
Yeah, everybody was in, locked and loaded, ready to go on time. Mostly refreshed. A couple people were clearly dragging.
You looked one of the worst, but I guess as a judge,
me?
You don't really need to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You walked in while I was eating food and you said, food. That would be wise, wouldn't it? And then you sat down with your monster energy and started up running the tournament. I was like, okay,
yep.
Ryan.
Yep, that's me.
I'm proud of you.
In fact, Michael Henry, who did stay at my house, and Brett stayed as well. We talked about Saturday night. You know, we didn't get a lot of sleep on Friday night. We should probably go to bed relatively early at 11:45.
And
next thing we know, it's 1 a.m. Like, you're just sitting there, you're talking, and then it's 1 o'clock. So it's like,
sounds about right.
So, Tim, you end up going to table 4, which was brought to us by Steven Sylvia. It's an industrial fabrication yard. And it was actually table. It was high rank. People really liked
actually,
this place.
Actually, we changed.
He was sent there, and then
did you get moved? Oh, that's right. You did get moved.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Steven. I was going to shout out your table.
Yeah. It was a gorgeous looking table.
That's right.
It was. We got sent the table. I think it was number 1. It was the one that was recorded.
Yeah.
So that was,
I didn't want to. Nobody was on the stream table because, like I said, we had a couple randomly assigned tables that would not get played. And I wanted to make sure since the captain had brought up his recording equipment, there was a game there every round. And so you were paired up with another known member of the Legion community. I saw y'all's pairing, and so I threw you over there.
Oh, yes. It was a good time. It was Michael, and I respect you too much to butcher your last name. So we're just going to say Michael S. from up north. Member of the Legion 99 community, of our community. So very, very well-known person. Very good player. And he was playing a really interesting list. I love Palp, but we don't see a whole lot of Palp these days, although our tournaments, for whatever reason, had a couple of them.
We had, yeah, I was surprised by
three?
The Palp we had.
Do we have three? Two or three?
Yeah, I think it's three.
I think it was three, yeah. It was three or four, yeah.
So Will played one. I played this one. I don't know who the third one was. But Michael's list was Palp, IRG, Triple Sniper, a Stormtrooper with Del and a Medbot, and then two Shores and two Mortars, and the Shores had the Heavies.
Nice.
We played KP, yeah. And we found a nice little piece of fence that was our middle KP. It was great. And then we found our own respective KPs in our corners that we would never interact with ever again, other than our one unit. And then so we played it out, and I was thinking, with the way this map was set up, the tank had so many good shots. Like, I just sat it in the corner, and I mean, he just couldn't hide, so it was heavy cover shots, lots of heavy cover, but still, like, shots.
Right.
I can still shoot, yeah. And, like, the tank has so many dice behind it and crit, too, on every shot, and whether no matter what gun you're using, if you're using the TLT or the missiles, like, you still have crit, too. All that to say, mathematically, it should have worked out, everyone. Scientifically, it should have worked. The plan was sound, and Michael and I talked after and said the plan was sound. It was there.
It didn't happen quite.
And again, this is another one where you can blame dice all you want. At the end of the day, we should have played payload. I could have pushed a payload, and then we didn't. We played KP because I thought with my pie plate I could do KP better. And again, I think I could have in theory, on paper. however, paper dice and real dice are not the same thing.
they
are slightly different. Not.
And so,
math and theory and math and practice, two different places.
So Palp got shot. Yeah. Let's see. I'm trying to think how far we got along. I think it was three or four times. I think three times. Palp got shot three times with the full weight of the tank. And by the end of the game, only had one wound on him. Between IRG and medbots. IRG did die, but still, he just was blocking everything. I couldn't get anything onto him. I was trying to suppress him, and he would just rally it off. All his rally rolls were coming up. I was like, I couldn't stop him at all. He just marched along. It's super frustrating to see Palp. He had burst of speed on Palp. He didn't even use it. He just was walking up, shuffling along.
I love the idea of old man Palp, just old man strolling,
yeah,
just casually knocking things down.
You can't see me right now in my chair because this is an audio medium, but like I'm like bobbing back and forth in my chair. Like, yeah, you're just dancing along, like, woo, doo, 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 doo. Dodge.
Did you know the occasional
time when Palpatine would Clone Wars stuff.
Yes.
You know, you wouldn't see Palpatine become the real Sidious until like one or two episodes of Clone Wars. And then it's just like, oh, that's right. That's why he's a bad man.
Yeah. So it was great. And so I guess the whole game, that kind of thing could be summed up with this. Two real units that stuck out to us, other than that, was A, towards the end of the game, as his units were all moving in towards the KP, a full tank shot into a strike team that was in heavy cover, so they did have low profile, which is a problem, but it's fine. And so still, whoa, full tank shot. You're going to cancel three, fair enough, but they're white dice. There's two units. We should be fine. I had crit two. I had an aim. Should be fine. Doesn't kill him. Survives.
Not fine at all.
And at that point in the game, I really needed tank to be killing an activation a turn, and they just couldn't do it like that.
Right.
So that, and then the other one that was really heartbreaking was my Wookiee chieftain, who really all weekend long, I should point out, basically behaved as an operative because he has vigilance on himself. The AT is on the clone commander. And so he's really just his own man. He's just out there living his best life, acting like operative chieftain. Running around, hopping agile scale, hopping over buildings and shit. So he hops over this building, jumps down behind the shore troopers and flanking them, and just rams it into them. Gets a full boat into them, and two guys survive first attack. All right, okay, happens. Yeah. Decent enough.
Red dice.
Yeah, I killed three. That's fine with Pierce. Little low, but okay, that's fine. I'll take it. So heavy and the leaders left. Next turn. Okay, we're going to start it off, attack him, because at this point I need him to kill these two guys, only two, and then get into melee with the other shore, even though I can't attack him, just to clog him up, right? just to just to stop them from being a problem, because they're pestering my guys on the point. Roll my dice. Didn't aim because I need him to move. But again, two guys. It should be fine. Should be fine. No. Nope. Only kill one. That's a double rainbow surge hit. Kills one unit.
Oof. Bogged down.
So the next turn, again, I really need him to get engaged because he couldn't clog him up last time. So now I really need you to get two actions in there. So I need you to kill and move. That's what has to happen. Mm-hmm. Again, six dice, surge hit, double rainbow. Should be fine. He had a dodge on him, so fair enough. I get two hits. He dodges one.
Cool.
And he blocks the other
50-50.
One. 50-50. And he blocks the other one. It's not 50-50. He doesn't surge. He has no surge token.
That's three blocks.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm thinking of surge. I'm thinking of the other one. Yeah. So, couldn't do it. So, three turns, a shore trooper survives against a Wookiee chieftain. And then, right after that happened, then my tank shot happened into that strike team, didn't kill him, and I just called it there. I actually conceded, which I don't really normally do, but like, if we didn't concede here, like, Michael and I were still laughing about it, and I was getting upset, but I was like, I'm still laughing. If I don't stop here, I'm not going to be laughing anymore because I can't kill anything. Yeah. I can't kill anything, and it's like, I need to stop because nothing's going to change. I can't, just the weight of bodies. My guys weren't saving for anything, so they were all wiped out. I said, my tank will live, but that's like, I think a tank in a phase two probably would have been scoring, but then he would have had like four guys on her. So yeah, I just conceded because I just couldn't kill anything. By the end of that game, I think I had three acts left. Probably would have been three if we had played it out. Would have had three acts left. And I had only killed one. I killed the IRG. That's it. So it was gross. Ooh. It was gross. And again, you can say all you want about dice, but I should have played a payload. I would have had a better shot.
I would have had a better shot. So you lost on turn zero, huh?
Yeah, I would have had a better shot. I see my own thinking. I get why I wanted to do key positions with a tank base. Mm-hmm. But the heavy cover and everything was just too much. So, yeah, couldn't get through it.
Okay.
But Will, how did your game go?
Will went to one of the greatest tables that we own, and I love it so, so very much. It gets so much conversation. Will got to play on Fort Christmas.
Oh, you did? Christmas. You lucky duck. I actually really like Fort Christmas, like play-wise.
I had a good time on it. I ended up there with Sean, your round three opponent, Tim. So I just realized he went from you to me over there.
I didn't realize that. Yeah,
three to four. Cool. Yeah. So same list, the Yoda Wookiees. And we also played Sabotage. But it went a bit differently. Fort Christmas has a lot of terrain on it in this setup.
Yes it does.
And so
I will say, because that's, we got a lot of feedback on that table.
Yep.
I have too much terrain in the box, but that way it's modular. You can move things and add things. And so during the setup, somebody I think just put all the terrain on the thing.
Oops.
And I didn't see it till people had already started playing on it. I was like, oh, there's too much terrain.
And I'll say, I made that kind of conscious decision because I did go around before, you know, when we were done. And obviously, I can't fine-tooth comb every table before the event with that many tables. But I looked and made sure that for every really dense table we had, we also had some really open tables.
We did.
And so you had an equal likelihood. Because I know I got several complaints from several people. They drew a bad table. They drew a table that wasn't great for their list. And just, you know, our stream table was one of my pretty more open tables. But for every table like that, we had a Fort Christmas, or we had the Jedha City block where there was lots of stuff everywhere. And that way you never had to play, you know, two similar tables.
You do want variety. You don't want it to be like Warhammer where it's stamped out to be a certain way every table.
I prefer balance over variety, but yes, matter of opinion. Yeah.
You can get both.
We are both. Yeah, but it was definitely, but so it was a little dense. Thick. It was a little dense. It was dense. But again, it's Fort Christmas, so it's all sparkly, and it's 1,000 pounds of glitter, which still exists in my home.
Ben,
glitter is the STD.
My opponent and I are defining terrain, and I said fully earnestly, I guess the reindeer are light cover. And both of us looked at each other in that moment and just like, we never thought we'd end up here, did we? You just have to laugh.
Well, there was also a discussion by someone else later on about the
Does the ribbon count?
Yes, the intention The intention of the bow. What is it? Does the ribbon count as cover?
Oh, God. And then the poinsettia is area light cover, yeah? Oh, mm-hmm. God. No, but it was fun once we got all that ironed out. But we played Battleline Sab, which is always strange. We kind of did like a major corner with our Sabs. Like mine were on my right, his were on his right. But since it's still battle lines, I was able to throw my barks over kind of to his corner and do some flanking shots with them that worked out pretty well. They both were able to just move, aim, shoot Yoda, and we did three Ooh. Wounds to him.
Wow. With two barks, that's cash money.
And he killed a bark in return. I was like, worth.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
Then the next turn he killed the other bark. It's just like, you boys are my MVPs, that's all. Just making the Yoda scared to do anything the rest of the game. Love you. And so he just sends in his melee Wookiees, and I was just able to murder Blender through them again. Like, I sent Obi-Wan into one, then Anakin did the thing on Hello There, which meant Anakin, like, not even that turn. That turn we just killed them. Then we dove into the next squad of Wookiees, and Anakin did the Hello There push thing, which meant Obi-Wan killed the Wookiees he was with on Anakin's activation. Then it was Obi-Wan's turn, and he double moved to find Yoda behind this piece of terrain and just murder batted him. And so at that point, it was just death. Death.
They cried on For Christmas.
Chewbacca was very sad. It was a bad time. And then to make sure I stayed ahead of Sean, I did make sure to bop one of his stabs to make it a 4-3 win to get my MOV a little bit better.
And Sean had given Josh a pep talk before this game. Like, listen, here's what Will's list.
No,
is.
Like, here's how I'm walking to the table and I see Josh is setting up, and Sean is, because Josh is from Atlanta as well, like, but so they know each other, they play at the same store, and so Sean's just like, come on, buddy, you gotta do it, you gotta do this for me, you gotta beat Will, I gotta get ahead of him somehow. and then the pep talk was ineffective. But it was a good game, we had a nice chit chat, and then, you know, this game was before a little lunch break, and we ended with probably an hour on the timer, just because we both had low activations. We both had a lot of naked phase ones, so it was just a lot of like move, evaporator, dodge, standby. Like, we each had like four units that mattered. It was kind of weird, but my four beat his four, so the end.
So at this point, this is round four. You have murdered two Yodas and a Bosk.
Yes,
is this correct?
Two Yodas, a Can Bosk, and a Palpatine.
I want to give you like Wilhelm Frog Sticker, like an official title, or Reptile Slayer, or
yeah, you do that.
Enemy of the small green people.
Well, Bosk isn't small and green, but he is green.
Yes, so sorry, enemy small lizard people.
Small
lizard.
After I
apologize.
Well, yes. You got Saber Throw Wilhelm into piece.
Lizard Slayer.
Yeah, sure. That'd be my Rocky Top open title or Game Con. Sorry, listen, not open.
You can get your shirt that says that, or a nice badge.
Yeah,
you know, some kind of medal.
Get a logo made here.
I'm doing a quick check.
Uh huh.
I think you killed two out of three Yodas.
Yeah, okay. I think there was one more.
Oh,
I think JJ had Yoda.
Yeah, he did. And we never played.
Because you
might have been
and
fun.
You didn't play. Okay. Yeah.
But
close to the Yoda. The Yoda.
But we've played four rounds, and I'm 3-1, which is never where I thought I would be.
No.
Not with that list. Yeah.
No, not at all.
So Tim, round five. You know, things are going. Things are definitely going.
Things are happening.
You end up on table 19, which is Tim Hannon's table.
It is.
Which I've titled The Ruins of Tim's Hopes and Dreams. That's right. Is the title of that table.
It was, in fact, not easy like Sunday morning. So
it was. Well, it was Sunday afternoon, so.
Yes, exactly. That's why. My morning was also not easy, but yeah.
There was no afternoon delight for Tim.
No. 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 So
Tim, who'd you play? How'd it go?
I played Kevin Zaloff, who had R2 in a land speeder, air speeder, Op Luke, and some snipers and troopers to fill.
I like
including a fleet trooper. Yeah, I really like the list. We played KP, Battle Lines, and Fortified. So extra barricades for everybody. This game.
This is the one that broke me.
I was doing okay. Yeah. The game the day before was a little bit rough. That morning was a little bit rough. Like I said, where I just couldn't get anything through. I was definitely starting to get a little bit salty on that one. But that's why we called it. Like, okay, I don't want to lose it. I like Michael. I don't want to lose it on him. He's a nice guy. And this game, most of this game was going pretty well. Okay. Going good. Tank's doing good things. Couldn't kill his snipers. For the love of God, I couldn't kill a sniper because low profile shouldn't be on strike teams, but that's fine. Makes them invincible unless you have massive die pools, which I did, and I still couldn't kill them. But Barks couldn't get pulled in time. I basically put Barks on one side of the map to try and deal with R2. Got R2 down to one health, but then he healed it back because that's fair. That's fine. It's what we're allowed to do. Evidently, you're allowed to repair yourself, which is, again, fine. Gives R2, like, way more health, but that's okay. You know, 4 more health. So who cares? And then I'm in the middle point. We're scoring. And as I said, even I got his Luke down. He was engaged with the Wookiee Chieftain. The Wookiee Chieftain was on 1. Luke was on, I think, 2 health. And they were fighting. And then he played I Am a Jedi. So neither one of us could do anything. At one point on the Chieftain, I took a standby. And then he did something. He's like, do you want to trigger your standby? I said, no. Because what am I going to do with it? I can't leave. I can't withdraw with a standby. And I can't fight. So... no, I'm just gonna stay in here, I guess. Start of the next round, he had forgotten that Luke was still in base to base with the Chieftain, and so I was able to just get a strike in there and kill Luke. So that was a good time. So the Chieftain was able to take out Luke. The Chieftain then got lit up by, I think it was the Landspeeder, which is fine. He did what he had to do. And then the middle point. Middle point was this big statue, and we've talked about this, and I don't know who set this table up this way. I hate having line of sight blockers as a middle piece. I hate it with a passion. I've had that problem for years, ever since my first Gen Con, because I played Ring Around the Rosie with Darth Vader and Luke Skywalker running around. And so this was a line of sight blocker, mostly. There was like one little piece of it that wasn't. I could not get any shots to kill any of his guys on the approach. And so basically the tank got up on top. We were able to, it wasn't on top of the whole thing, but it was on top of enough of it. And because of all the weird angles and things, and because of strafe was awesome. And basically made it to where I was scoring 4 units on the point. And again, taking some pot shots. He had a unit touching it, a 4-man naked squad. Tank, who's also touching the same cover at this point, shoots him because he's now looking over the terrain and looking at them. Shoots him, full boat. Trooper leader, unit leader lives. Unit leader lives. I have no other way, nothing left to kill him with. There's no way I could get around the line of sight blocker to shoot him. But I was still winning on the point. Yep, still winning on the point. Uh-huh. And then R2, who scored secret mission.
Oh.
And then got back in the vehicle. And then triple move because it's a land speeder. Triple move, compulsory. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, long story short, did his move, and then compulsory last in case he had to displace. Although we ruled it, actually, Ryan came over and helped us with this, helped it to move, so he actually didn't displace. If he had, it wouldn't have mattered, to be quite honest, because then I just would have still been touching just somewhere else, but it's okay. And then R2 got out and touched it. So I spent...
it's like, tag.
I spent a good chunk of this game pretty confidently winning that middle point and winning the game. And then R2 came from across the map and scored 2 victory points to win the game on turn 6. And that broke me. The fact that you can play your heart out and play your hardest and do things right, and then one unit can come out of left field with 2 victory and score 2 victory points. One of them being for free, basically. For 55 points. Is dumb, and it makes me not want to play this game ever again, because it invalidates so much of what you work hard for, of just like, nope, I just come over here and do this, it's fine.
So without secret mission, because we have beat the secret mission drum pretty hard. Yep. And I'm still a believer that R2-D2 needs to be higher in cost. I still think he needs to be higher in cost. But if it just been a regular body, would you just have tied on victory points?
Yes.
I mean,
and we would have tied kill points, and I would have won on kill points.
Well, just from the way you told me that story, the thing I want a clarification on, you had 3 units on the middle point, 4. Correct? You had 4, and he had Were you guys counting R2-D2 in the speeder as a unit leader?
No, he got out and touched.
Okay.
Because I know, like,
to make sure we got that right.
Yes, he double moved, and you know you can't do anything other than disembark. But the disembark was all he needed.
That's all you needed.
So he hopped out one. I spent all six rounds, and he just comes in and just does that. Okay, that is the antithesis of all that I am, and that is the epitome of unfun. Like, if I'm a new player and I play that, I probably don't come back to this game ever again because that was such a negative play experience. Well, and the opponent was great. Like, he was a great dude. And I felt bad for being so mad. Like, I told him, I was like, dude, you did it great. You did it right. It's not your fault this unit exists. Like, it's not your fault that that's a thing. But that was beyond frustrating.
And I know Tim will probably disagree with this, yep. But I value however it comes.
Of course you do.
I do like that there are different ways you can interact with
it. It's here are your objective conditions. Here's how you win the game. And now here's this thing you can do for borderline free to break everything. And not only that, your unit can now score twice. So you can score your sequel where
low scoring means that he's even more effective, and
he's much more effective in KP than no, he's in breakthrough or
bounty cover supplies. Bounty is not parity at this point. No. Like whatever they change it or whatever they're doing, we'll see.
Hopefully, it'll be a very nice change. I'm hopeful for some changes we've seen.
They're not
so far.
They're in no way equivalent, you know. And it's tough. Yeah, right. And it feels bad to win that way, which I know I've done that to Tim before.
It feels awful. it's just.
And I do have in fact, we were joking. Keith Holt and I were joking this tournament. We have a strict shoot R2-D2 on sight policy.
Yeah.
Like anytime there's a chance, he dies first. I will actively move out of my way to kill him, and that may cost me a game too. But it's better than him scoring secret missions.
I almost had him. Right. I tried to do that. The barks couldn't do it. If I pulled my bark like one turn sooner, I might have been able to do it, but I couldn't pull the bark out.
Will, you have gone to table 13. That is Stephen Sylvia's Dark Sith Temple.
Uh-huh.
You're playing, who are you playing, and what have you done?
I'm playing Nicholas, 5th Trooper representative at our event.
I guess Dustin Harvey did actually play. He showed up to drop off some tables.
He showed up. He lent us some.
He was there Friday and Sunday, yes, so.
Yes. Well, he also put some paint models into the overall Rocky Top Game Con, and so I think he was going to see if he'd won. So.
He was the 5th Trooper's playing representative, then, we'll say.
Yes.
He told me he drove 9 hours here with no AC to play, so I gave him props for that. I think he was in Arkansas, that kind of thing.
Oh.
So he drove across all of Tennessee. He said it broke like the day before the trip, and he just needed to come. So he sweated it out to get here, literally. But we both met at the 4-1 table or the 3-1 table, seeing who would go 4-1. And it really came down to this roll to see who was going to get blue player, because he and I had actually sat next to each other at Shoalsbrow the night before, and kind of talked it out. And I told him a lot of my battle deck and kind of what my list does.
Your philosophy.
And he was basically saying, well, I don't want to do any of that. That's never happening. I said, well, we'll see. And then, of course, we play each other. And, of course, he gets the role to be blue player. So, literally, he flips his deck, and it is almost the exact opposite cards for each category. I think we had some overlap on conditions and maybe a deployment, but not much. So
basically, things you didn't want to play, necessarily.
Yeah, things that were very bad. He's playing some typical droid nonsense, generic STD, 5 B1s, 2 Magnus, right. 2 Spiders.
All the good stuff in droids.
Yep, 4 snipers and a repair droid, I think. Magnus with stuff. Magnus with comm jammers, which was interesting and not fun.
I saw him play with that comm jammers once in another table, and I was like, oh, that's kind of gross.
Comm
like,
jammers and Into the Fray he had on his Magnus.
Because you don't see it a lot, so someone's like, wait, can I not? I can't order them? No, you can't. That's what.
No, granted, with Jedi, it's like I can still order Obi-Wan on Hello There or that kind of thing, but it's not as fun. So it just kind of went downhill. We're on Intercept, Hemmed In, and Fortified was the other one, yeah. And, you know, I had some lucky saves to start with, like, I had an RT get shot by an Ion Spider and blocked all 4s, meaning no Ion, but it was just kind of rolling downhill. Magnus and stuff all, you know, crits through cover, killed did some wounds to Anakin, and then Magnus ran out and bonked him. Then Obi-Wan ran out, killed the first Magnus, and then Hello There to try to dive, but it was kind of futile at that point. Like, he's swarming and killing and doing everything correctly, and it's just like, it's a bad matchup, bad time, But, you know, good player. He did everything he had to do. And
yep,
nice.
We both kind of acknowledged that it was going to be a snowball in either direction. Like, I was going to roll through everything he did to me and then crash into his droid ball and just murder all of it. Or he was going to do what he did and just methodically pick me apart, which happened. And so it was all good. He got it. We called it on like turn four, but mathed it out to where I had won it on turn. I had at least 1 point on the first two scores, but he said he was, you know, I agreed that he would get all three for the final one. So we called it 10-2 in his favor. And there was much yes. rejoicing from the Sean because he had gone 4-1 and I was banished to 3-2.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yes.
You'd ridden the wave, got to the top, and fell right off that surfboard.
Yep. I had avoided the droid. I had avoided the droid menace all day, and then finally it smacked me down. So yeah. I was scared of them. I didn't have much answers other than make them play hostage. So, more bids.
So,
because even with that 10-2 defeat, if we go over to the MOV scoreboard.
Oh, Sean had like four games go 0-0 or 2-2, whatever.
Yeah, your MOV is just slightly higher than his.
Oh, and then if I'd won that game, you know, whatever.
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah. So, speaking of that, so we're at the end here. We're going giving out prizes, and Ryan's like, hey, Ben, can you go and separate out the prize piles? We had so much stuff to give away.
Yep.
I did not know we had this much stuff to give away until I started trying to figure out how to divvy the piles up. So we had lots of nice raffles, beautiful things that were donated by convention vendors at the hall, yep. which was very, very nice. We had some just great stuff to give away, but we were able to give away our top three in faction prizes because we had a relatively nice split. Of factions
yeah.
In,
yeah,
inside
it,
of
it
our...
It was pretty nice how it rounded out.
18 Imperials, we had 11 Rebels, 13 Separatists, and 9 Republic. So
hooray!
I mean, nice little balance there.
Yeah. I played equal. 3 of them.
You did. Listen, I don't know. I really don't know how that's even possible because it was random pieces. But you did get 3
okay.
of those.
It's okay. I beat two. You know, I beat 2 of them. That meant the best Republic really was just me and Sean.
But as I'm giving out these orders, I'm like, all right, so second in faction for the clones, for the Grand Republic Army, Wilheim. And Will, as you're walking up, what does Sean say to you?
I walk past Sean, and he gives me a big smile and says, great job, Will. And I stop mid-stride and just kind of stare at him for a minute and say, you too, pal. And I go claim my second place Republic prize.
So... You know, Will, I'm not a petty person by nature, but I am willing at this point to declare Sean an enemy of the podcast if you want this. Like, that's some cold stuff right there. All I'm saying.
It was good-natured cold stuff. It was...
Good-natured cold, but if you want...
I don't need
if you
solidarity,
want,
Ben. It's fine.
All right, okay. Remember, well, it takes two to declare an enemy of the podcast. So
all right.
I'm offering my support to you this time if you want to call him.
I thought we needed right, three. Sean. I thought we needed a majority.
No, you just gotta have two to get an enemy. To get a arch enemy, you have to have three of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The rules are in the bylaws. It's pretty deep. It's section 4, paragraph 5.
Daisy's rubbing on my microphone. So enjoy.
She also declares Sean.
She does. She says, I will give solidarity.
Thank you.
Excellent. So Will, go ahead. It's your language, your voice.
Gotta hear
it on the thing.
Get this cat out of here. Okay. Yes, I declare Sean from Atlanta an enemy of the podcast. I will get you one day when there's Atlanta events. Which you don't have to run. Don't listen to Ryan.
You do have to run them. You're the chosen
Just ask
one
of us to
I would really
do
love
it.
You to run.
Honestly, we will come and do it.
Yeah, but remember, it's always better if you get the local because then there's someone they can reach into. You pull.
But if they
Atlanta's
have none,
a city of 2 million people.
If they
like,
have
they
none, then
people.
You run one and find someone there that you can say, "Hey, that's this true. Is easy. You know, just maybe start
be a
doing
local
it.
Contact." Yeah, if you just need a tournament like person to run the event during the day, it's because you want to play. We can find people to do that.
And we'll do an episode on this probably again. In
you
the
can also play and run the event if it's like
yeah, it's small enough.
you know, 12, 16
But at the end of the day, easily. Does it matter how well you play? Because who cares with R2?
You're oh, yeah, go back in your pants. Oh,
sad boy.
At the end of the day.
All right, so let's talk about...
Closes the trap door back on Tim. Get back down there.
So,
yeah, get out of here.
I am sure that Wally has great pictures of what he painted. We'll try to snap some photos real quick, but the lighting that's in our space, because we were underneath the overhang.
His Instagram, he posted it.
Yep.
They're absolutely beautiful. He sent them all to me. But our faction prizes were fantastic.
Yep.
So Will was competing for the Mace Windu with robotic hand, like Revenge Windu. It was a beautiful, beautiful model. Lots of dice there. There was an Admiral. Was it Admiral Trench?
Admiral Trench.
I was like, if I'd known, I don't know that I would have
There's
DO'd.
There's a reason I didn't tell you. Did you?
It was beautiful. I may not have gotten
it's an
it,
inside
it was
job.
Awfully beautiful.
It's a conspiracy against you, Ben.
Like that's the second. Like so, the New Orleans one. I really wanted that Dooku. I wanted, and Lupo got it, and I'm proud for him. But I'm a little jealous still. But that, I may just go buy this Trench and have Will paint it for me because it's a beautiful looking bottle. Wally did a fantastic job.
Wally
with
did do a really
colors.
Good job.
I will write on the bottom of the base, not for best in faction at Rocky Top.
Exactly.
Droids.
One of the coolest prizes that Wally painted for us was a Boba Fett riding a Rancor that went to me and Ben's favorite list. We spent the first day scoping around looking for the list that we would like to play, and you know, we as STABcast members love the bullshit.
We appreciate
yeah we are yeah when we say best list, that should really be in quotation marks five times, because we love Jake. We love the weird. I'm still playing Gary and Larry. Weird. Like I mean I just love it so much.
We're just trying to be on the cutting edge of what could be the next meta, and so how do you know
exactly.
Unless you try.
Yeah. We are out there exploring in the darkness of meta to find the next meta.
Yes, we are your STABcast explorers. Join us on this journey through what in the world is this list?
So, yeah, the model was really neat. It had a broken sign with the Rocky Top had been cut in half by a lightsaber, some UT helmets at the base. He really knocked it out of the park.
He did. You did a great
and,
job.
And we gave it to James Brown and his Commander Vader triple dues. ATST, just all the big heavy hitters of the Empire, all in one list, and still managed to get to 9 activations.
It's 2 Shore Troopers and 2 DF Mortars. You look at the thing like, well, what am I supposed to be shooting at?
Nothing. You lose.
And I don't know.
Good day.
Exactly. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
You play you play sabotage or recover, and the Shore Troopers don't have any heavies on them. So you just shoot the Shore Troopers, and then he's got to have Vader pick up boxes.
I mean, he went 3-2, came in 20.
Yeah, he did.
Out of 50 players, so that's not a bad place to be. So.
No, and jank doesn't mean like you went 0-4 with terrible.
No, absolutely not.
It's just,
like I said,
not typical.
Fantastico.
Yeah, but it was thanks for everybody who sponsored prizes. Those models were provided by Steven Sylvia, who also brought a bunch of tables. Mark Wally painted all the best in faction and the Rocky the Rancor for us. All the vendors that donated stuff. Army Painter sponsored our paint awards. It was a really cool event, and thanks for everybody behind the scenes who pitched in and helped.
Absolutely.
Out.
Got a shout out Jim Butler, Steven Sylvia, Austin Miller, Dustin Harvey, Matt Goditis, Jeremy Appleton, Michael Henry brought tables, Chris Vandergrift brought tables, and of course all the ones that Dan Wolf made for us that we have adapted and updated and kept rolling. Mm-hmm. Will has printed tables and done things. Everyone got some beautiful Sunsphere prints. They were delightful. Fantastic. Thank you, everybody. We had a grand and glorious time.
Yeah, we really did.
Yeah, and
it was a community effort.
Thank Steven for running the convention thing?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. It was great. Yeah.
So our next event, where are we heading next, boys?
Around
me,
you know.
And possibly Tim, probably not.
Probably
possibly
not Tim.
Or
yeah,
going,
probably not Tim.
Going to Atlantic City. I got to. I kind of have to go. it's my only top four at a major, so I got to kind of try to go defend my title.
Yeah, I'm sad I can't go. But
it's probably not going to happen because I'm so out of practice. But I'll be there.
Yeah. If it wasn't for flights, I'd be there. But yeah.
The American Team Championship, July 15th through 17th. I think tickets are still available.
Yeah, they are still available.
I'm not going to be able to go. It's a class weekend. So
I probably might be able to play Saturday, but probably not Sunday. We'll see.
And Tim's not available either. He's going to be out of town.
Yes, I'll be out of town.
So I hate it that there's a local thing that, you know, 3/4 of us are not making. So
I'll try.
It's up to you.
Will, you can be our ambassador. STABcast ambassador.
Yeah.
There you go.
I mean, I'll go play Shadow Collective, sure.
Show us a new meta, Will. Show us the new meta.
Then after that, so that's mid-July. Then a little bit later in July, in 23rd and 24th, is Lone Star, which I technically still have a ticket for. I keep monitoring flight prices.
I'm very frightful.
Yes, I like to fly. I'm not afraid of flying. I keep monitoring prices to see if they will go down. So I'm trying not to cancel it to last minute because I really did enjoy going last time. Everything was wonderful. We had a great time and a really good competition there. Good. The After Legion, as Ben would call it, was also wonderful.
Oh, so good.
Yeah. And it's the location of it is fairly accessible to most people because Dallas is such a big airport when prices are normal. So I know I'm not the only
one. You're only really 20 minutes outside of Dallas. Yeah. Like, it was an easy drive.
I know I've talked to a few other players who were hoping to go, and I know I'm not the only one that's having the flight price issues. So we'll see. So hopefully. Right. But I'm not holding my breath.
That's followed by Gen Con August the 4th through 7th. Ryan and I are signed up for Thursday Legion. Woo-woo.
Yes, sir.
And then, you know, Mega Games after that.
I want to hear all about the... Yeah, I don't care about the Legion. I want to hear all the Mega Games. That's what I want to hear about.
That'll be another special episode.
Yep. I think I've signed up for three of them and then signed up for two. Okay.
I've signed up for two. So. They sold real quick.
They always do.
So, it'll be fun. Nova is followed that. I don't think any of us are going to make Nova this year.
Not I.
No,
it's been sold out.
Yeah, it's sold out.
And they're sold out.
And they have a wait list. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, they sold out quick. They also, again, one of those things that went very fast.
Yeah, but also it's one of those events. You know, I've been to enough of these things. If you're in the area, I don't know that I would fly in with this plan, unless there's other things you want to do at the convention. But if you fly in and have an army in a tray and wait patiently by the TO desk, if they have a no-show, they'll happily take your money and let you play.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Or if someone has to have a buy, like they'll find they'll squeeze you.
Yeah, you'll find, yeah. So if you're local or are willing to take that risk, I think I've been to one event where the drops and the people who showed up weren't in concordance, so somebody had to walk away sad. But it's only happened once, and I've done this a lot.
Yeah.
So after that, we've got SoCal. Me and Will are planning to go.
Yeah.
We do have dates now, the 21st and 23rd.
Ooh.
Super excited.
Oh, maybe I'll look at that one so that way I can cancel it last minute too. That'd be great.
Yeah,
as is tradition. Well,
you know, because it's something we keep forgetting because I never see it advertised anywhere. The Michigan GT is in September 30th through October 2nd.
Okay.
And so Jay Muth and I were talking real hard last night at supper about it. My only fear is the structure. It's a little pricey to play three games on a Saturday and then top four cut. And then there's a skirmish event on Sunday. It's a little pricey for just three games on a Saturday. But if you're in the Michigan area,
well, that's the thing. Like I said, it's in Michigan. Oh.
Well,
I got family up that way.
Yeah, I've got family up there.
Ooh, I second that.
Yeah, I know people I can stay at for housing, and then they're only 25 minutes outside of Lansing. So
yeah,
but if you're in that area, like I said, Michigan GT is rolling strong on September 30th through October 2nd. So
okay,
that's exciting stuff. Exciting stuff.
Speaking of exciting things, Will,
the news. Shadow Collective, everyone's favorite.
Everyone's new favorite because we have to.
It's so fun. I'm excited.
Are you ready?
We must sell the models. Everyone? We must keep the company shills going.
Because
I'm not to be salty.
You know that army called Gar? Well, now there's a guy named Gar. So prepare for all the problems.
That's true.
Yeah. I had at least three people say they were going to play Gar with Super Commandos, and I went, huh?
Yes. It's Mr. Saxon.
Mr. Gar Saxon. Sir, Esquire. Militant Commando.
Anglo.
He is a commander for the same faction icon as Maul, the kind of Death Watch hand thing going on there. He has a surging red save, 5 wounds, and 2 braveries, and he surges crit.
So he's a Mando.
He's a Mando.
Yep. He's a Mando.
He's speed 3 with jump 2. He's a Mando with a jetpack.
Yep.
He has allies of convenience, so he can issue order to any mercenary types, you know, like the Pikes and the Black Suns and all that. And then we get spicy. We have Compel.
Ooh, I love that.
We have Compel with a bunch of troopers that don't use bravery values as easily, so they might get scared.
Mm-hmm. Seems good. I love it. For units with Dauntless too, huh?
Oh yeah, yeah. That seems all right.
Oh yeah,
seems real good. Yeah, interesting.
And then continuing the Mando trend, we have Impervious for his armor.
Yes,
and we get a cheeky Sharpshooter 1. No big deal.
That's nice.
Yeah,
that's nice. The fact that Sharpshooter 1 at this point is like an afterthought after all these other keywords. It's just like, oh yeah, also Sharpshooter 1. Because why not?
Sharpshooter.
With Surge Crit.
Most characters need it nowadays to get through anything that's out there.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah.
Unless you cast
decent weapon profiles, like two reds in melee, and a rainbow with an extra black die at range 1-2.
That's a bark pool, sir.
His sidearm. That is bark pool. I don't know bark pool.
It is
at range 1-2.
And then we get two trainings.
God, yeah, this upgrade this, bar.
This bar
is
out of room. We can't
strap
fit
in
anymore.
Strap in two trainings, a comms, two gear, two armament.
And I thought to myself when I saw the card, I was like, what kind of armaments are we you need to add two? Because he already has a great weapon at range 1-2 and can move to get to range 1-2.
Well,
and I mean, we just talked about up close and personal last episode, which is a fantastic card for these types. So what the hell is he equipping?
You remember those cards that Boba Fett has that are order cards?
Yeah.
That give him weapons?
Mm-hmm.
What if they were just upgrades instead?
Cards. Yeah, what if they were just cards?
They were just armament cards that you could switch between and get what you wanted out of him. Wouldn't that be
better and
cool? That
seems like a solid
cool?
plan.
It's a good thing that's not possible.
Well, turns out, Gar Saxon has three armament options for his two slots that give him several different weapons.
I bet he does.
So I will say, I really hope this is how they do Boba Fett with their changes.
Yeah. Yes. I
like this.
Because Boba Fett looks at all of this and just cries. Just
started.
Also, we glossed right over something.
What?
What?
He's 105 points.
We did.
Well, he is, but that's without any upgrades on him. But yes, because he's going to be chock full of upgrades.
You're going to load this man.
He's going to end up like 130.
Yeah.
He's going to be fat boy.
Yeah. He'll get chunky.
He'll be fat boy.
He is the same cost as Lando.
Yes.
Yeah. But Lando gives you extra command cards.
And he's sharp too.
With two dice at range.
Also,
three.
Lando,
three with
Lando
white
has a cape.
Saves.
You said you wouldn't
with
do this.
White like, saves. You're right. I'm trying.
You said you would go
he
to
has
your
a
corner.
Cape.
We're talking about good cards, Ryan.
Jump 2, speed 3, surging red, save 105 points.
He's only got one pool at range 2. It's fine. But maybe, if he didn't?
For 15 more points, you could get Saxon's Gellar 90 rifle. Range 1-4, red, black, white, high velocity. Oh, love to see that come back.
Uh-huh.
Lethal 1.
Long shot 1.
So it could be range 5, if that's the thing you're into.
But it's cumbersome like Cassian Sniper, right?
No.
No, in fact it isn't.
But there's no native pierce.
You have to spend an aim.
No.
And it's going to be real hard to get aims on him, I'm sure.
Well,
I'm sure it's going to be really tough to get an aim on him.
Okay,
I'm sure that won't come up later.
I was going to say, if you only get an aim shoot, you have to choose between lethal and long shot. But
okay. Move on. We'll come back to that.
Next, we have his Z3X jetpack rockets, which are a 2-3, 3-red tappable weapon.
They expend like Mando rockets?
No, it's a tap. It's an arrow.
No, it's a tap.
Oh, so surely it's way more expensive than Mando rockets.
We'll get there. It has blast and cycle.
Yes. So don't worry, Ryan. You don't have to worry about spending that little refresh action. It'll
just
come back
three times a game. And then a cheeky,
I want to die.
And then a cheeky impact too.
Well, yeah, it's a rocket.
So here's the thing. It's a hog gun, but with an extra red instead of a white.
And it's range 2-3.
Don't forget surge.
And it's only 10 points.
10 points.
It's 10 points.
Yes. Yep. Yep, yep. Yeah. And then finally, just for taste, we have Saxon's Z6 Flame Projector. It is a melee or range 1 black-white blast spray suppressive flamethrower.
What?
Which is an expendable weapon.
I was going to say, it is expendable. Yes. So it's a one-time
use. It's only one time you dump five white,
five black
suppressive.
You'll also never see this this will never see the light of day, but that's fine. Like
it's only five points.
It is.
But I think if you're looking at
the other things,
though. I think it's good for the approach.
Yeah,
maybe.
I don't think it's.
I think you bring the other two, but
I think you bring the other two. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm
saying. I think you just bring the sniper to keep his cost down, but I could be wrong.
That rocket's real good. That rocket's real good.
Well, I can see saying I don't have 15 points and 10 for the rocket, so I may just do the rocket and the flame.
He's gonna get fat.
Like flame projector, I can see going, oh, I'm surrounded by B1s. I only have two red dice. Never mind. Yeah, flame them up.
Right. I'm not saying, we all know flamethrowers are good. I'm just saying the other two are really good.
Yeah, the two are really good.
It is a nice, I think people are just going to bring it how they want. You know, if you think that's more valuable, do it.
I appreciate the flexibility and the versatility.
Yeah, it's cool. Yes. It feels Mando-ish to have the options.
Agree.
And then he's a commander, everyone, so he gets command cards, yeah?
Yeah, he does.
That's something I've been
told. I'm sure they're good. I'm sure they're fine.
He has a 1, a 2, and a 3 pip.
They're mediocre. Wow. They're just mediocre. They're fine. They're fine.
Mediocre.
These will not be overpowered in any way, form, or fashion.
No, we're good.
Gar Saxon has order cards.
Yes, he does.
Starting with his 3 pip, victory or death. Exclamation point.
Victory or death?
I hope someone just...
Looking how the Shadow Collective is shaping up, we won't need those last two words.
Hold on. I want someone to cross that victory and just put cake or death. Like, just put cake.
I want that. Exactly. I thought the exact same thing. We're just going to make a picture of Eddie Izzard.
Yeah. I want Eddie Izzard's face on there flying around says cake or death. Carry on.
I now need an Eddie Izzard Gar Saxon model.
Carry on.
In his executive transvestite.
I hate all of you.
I can, in the blue suit, call it day. Done. I'm going to go get that. Go into the internet.
All right. Well, Ben's going to be in Photoshop for a few hours. This card orders Gar Saxon and two troopers.
Okay.
And when he,
which makes sense for three pip.
When he issues an order to that unit, they gain an aim token. You know, that he wanted
those. It's kind of like Luke's two pip, right?
Yeah. So
that's fair and balanced. Yeah.
And then Gar Saxon and each friendly special forces unit gain outmaneuver, which is no big deal, and don't worry about it.
Because they don't have dodges, so it's fine. You're just giving them aims.
We'll get there.
It's fine.
Yeah. So it's good. It's good. Look at that.
I mean, they don't have
dodges. Then we have a two pip.
Seething over here.
We have a two pip. Fight another day. Gar Saxon and two troopers on a two pip.
Okay, so I can't order my bus. I can't order the bus.
But it's also three orders on a two pip.
Yep.
No, that's also true.
But here we go. Gar Saxon cannot issue orders beyond range one.
Ooh.
Oh, that's sad. But when Gar Saxon issues an order to a unit, they gain one dodge token. Neat.
Okay. Cool.
Gar Saxon and each friendly special forces unit gain outmaneuver.
Okay.
Oh, hang on.
Free.
So
that happens again.
It's not special forces you ordered.
It's all of them.
No, it's not special forces. Yeah.
It's just all of them. It's just the ones out there. Just if there's things they do.
And
they just
this
do.
Time you have a dodge. From the card.
Yeah, for him and two units.
If you issued orders. Yes, but if not,
if you're running him with your Mandos, which you don't do that. I don't think. Right.
Why would you do that?
And then we have a one pip marked for elimination. It just orders Gar Saxon. But he gets two aims.
Cool.
Which is kind of the thing I was trying to bring up as a downside earlier, but never mind. then choose an enemy commander or operative. That unit gains 4 observation tokens and 2 suppression tokens.
That is a
cool, everyone?
Oh my god. You didn't have to shoot him. Just, hey, that guy? Yeah, screw that guy.
Hey, that guy right there? No.
Oh, did I not kill him with Gar Saxon because you defended really well? Everybody else, shoot him.
Every gun we have 3 suppression on Luke. Man.
Let's give him 2 more. That's fine. No,
exactly.
Rally that, bitch.
He would, but that's fine.
All right, so if you do want to sniper him out, you can get the lethal one and the long shot one for range 1, pierce, high velocity, non-cumbersome, 3-dice gun. Because at least all the other ones at least are 2-dice. But no, this is a 3-dice sniper shot.
Or you just get up close with his 4-die gun.
Yeah, you do. Ugh. Or mark somebody else for death, murder somebody else, and let the rest of your army take care of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, just mark something up with those 4 observation tokens and then fire your rockets into something with 2 aims, just in case. I don't know. Yeah. It's fun and wholesome, good times.
Fun and very wholesome.
Yeah. No, sometimes
with a black white fire, a flame projector, you know, roll, sometimes you don't get all the hits you want in a black white roll.
Now,
you need those two aims.
But who is he going to be having these fun times with? Is he just going to be by himself leading pikes and Black Sun?
Oh, the Maldolorians have been something people have been clamoring to hear. Once we knew they were coming, we wanted to see what they would be like.
Everything is fine, Ryan.
So let's read about the Mandalorian Super Commandos. They are for 75 points. You get three models for them. They are Jump 2, Defend 1, Impervious, and Independent Aim 1.
So if you say same cost as Rebel Mandos, and how we say Rebel Mandos have these cool keywords, but no tokens to fuel them.
Yes,
that's neat.
That if you issue them an order, they get a dodge. If you don't, they get an aim.
Isn't that cool and that fun?
It's so fun.
And what if you had abilities that just said they gain outmaneuver? You don't have to order them for
it. You have to order them. Yeah. They just exist.
Or if you just gave them orders for a free dodge on Fight Another Day. Wow.
They are one health. Two courage, they surge on defense, red defense die.
Yep, they're Mandos.
Speed three,
jump two.
They're Mandos. That weapon profile, I like a lot.
Man, imagine only troopers. Shooting at range two. Wouldn't that be sad?
I want to die.
I don't even like stomping on you with this. It's just so true.
They don't surge hits. They're fine.
They don't, but they range 1 to 3 though. Like you don't like so the Rebel Mandos have to jump in.
I know.
Like they have to go close to do this. Well, these guys can be at range 3. Black White is not bad at range 3.
No, I guess
with
not.
Probably 4 models in your army. Like that's not a bad place to be. And if you're range 2, you just upgrade that to 2 black dice per model. Yeah.
Well, so your die pool's going to end up being, and we'll spoilers alert, it's going to be what? 3 black, 5 white, 2 red.
Possibly,
it depends.
Potentially.
It depends on what you get.
Depends on your upgrades. And they, of course, have the extra, you know, the heavy body, the training slot, the comms, the gear, the grenade, which happens on a lot of these troopers, and, of course, an armament. So
For taste.
Grenade seems odd. I will say the grenade seems odd.
It does. And the armament seems odd because you've got a lot of weapons here already.
Well.
Like, you already have 3 options on the base card. What else could I possibly want to add here?
Well.
Would you like me?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, you know.
I like how you gave none of this for me to talk about, guys. I see what you did.
You're busy.
You knew how it would go.
Yes, yes.
You would start vomiting mid-reading these cards. It's okay.
That's right.
Yes. We need your blood pressure to go up silently.
Hey, Ryan.
If you died and said nothing else, we wouldn't know.
Hey, Ryan. You know those jetpack rockets you talked about?
Yeah.
You know, these guys get a copy of that. And it's range 4, red die each. It's gone. It's expends.
All right, so it's just like the Rebel.
Yeah, it's got blast. Nice, right? It's got impact 1 per die, you know. And then and then it's got critical 1 per guy.
Per die. Wait. So that's it.
Right. Does yours not come with critical?
Moving on.
To be honest, I'm less worried about that. That's no
difference.
Because
they don't surge hit. Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't already surge
and
hit.
And it ignores cover.
It's got blast, so it ignores
cover. It's literally
cover.
Just
the only
them
thing
surge,
that gets in the way is a dodge token. So
now, there is a difference. Ryan's can shoot at range 3 to 4.
Yeah, these are four just only. Range
okay.
4.
Okay, I didn't know that. See, they're worse. So. Ha!
don't know that I've ever shot them at range 3, but, you know, that's something.
Yeah.
If you get
every time Keith has
bit.
Ever shot me with them, they've never been range 3. They've always been at range 4. Always. But, you know,
but
at least you're range limited.
And then
it.
We have a unique gear upgrade for them as well.
Cool.
Super Commando Combat Shields. They're for the Mandalorian Super Commandos only, those resistance scrubs.
So shielded.
You get shielded too.
Two.
You just get 2 shields. They don't come back, you know. But
I was gonna say it doesn't come back.
It's 10 points for 2 ablative wounds.
Right.
Isn't that fun?
I'll take that to not have 10 points to not have to make 2 saves.
Yeah. All day. Yeah. But
By comparison, for those of you who don't remember, Sabine Wren has a personal combat shield. She gets shielded 1, but she does get the ability to recharge that 1.
Yes.
Right.
So, I mean, you only get the 2 and they never come back, but yeah.
And the scary thing is you can spam this. Like you're gonna pay 30 points of your Maldalorian army to get six extra
wounds. Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
because we've talked about how their body count, their health count's real low for these guys.
Yeah.
Yep.
And that's a rebel problem.
Yeah, maximum well, five, but we'll get there. So we talked about that heavy upgrade. They have four options for that slot. Four of them.
Yeah, they do.
And the first one is just another dude. Another dude, you know, just an upgrade guy.
Well,
you know, unlike before when those were just blank, he gives you cash surge too.
Yeah.
He has two surge tokens on him for when you need to hit when you roll your attack dice.
That's right.
And at 24 points, mm-hmm. he's actually 1 point cheaper per wound than the regular guys.
Yes. But they do that with the upgrade bodies all the time, you know.
For core troopers, yep. You're right.
How much is a Beskad duelist?
Oh, God, I don't even
know. One second. I got this up, actually. I pulled this. I knew this conversation was coming, so I went ahead and did
it. They're like 28?
28, yeah, yes. Yeah,
okay. So,
they're actually more expensive.
He's cheaper than the following options, at least. But for an extra 3 points over the squad wound count, you get the duelist keyword in red and melee. That's neat. Anyway, the super commandos get a gunslinger, which is nifty. He's a 1-2 black, white, lethal one die pool.
Yep.
Yeah.
So if you want close range, you can bring a gunslinger to throw extra dice for 30 points. Or
and if you didn't order them, you got that aim token.
Yeah, you get that lethal one.
Yeah. Both of their non-unique, isn't just the generic dude, get to do cool things with aim tokens. So I think you take these guys if you're not planning on issuing them orders. Basically, if you're not running Gar Saxon, if you're running other commanders, I think take these two guys.
Yeah, I'd say so.
But you know, 8 black and 2 white, that's a heck of a thing at 105 points,
isn't it?
Yep,
with lethal one.
Yeah.
Or you can go a bit longer range and get a super commando marksman who throws a rainbow die at 1-3 and gets precise one. So you can reroll some extra white dice with your aim.
That's also a heck of a pool. If you want to hold them back, I mean, red, 7 black and a white.
Yeah. My favorite about both of these is that they have names that are keywords, but they don't grant that keyword, thankfully.
They do not grant that keyword. They grant different keywords.
Like, you don't get marksman with your marksman, and you don't get gunslinger with your gunslinger, because, God.
That would be horrifying.
No gunslinger.
That would be horrifying.
And then we have a named character for our final upgrade here.
He's pretty good.
It is Rook Cass.
Pretty good.
She is 2 wounds to add to the squad. So already multiplying that health with the shield and everything.
Love that.
She is range 1-2, red, white. So already. So,
and
retinue maul.
It hurts.
And leader.
And oh. It hurts me.
God.
Ryan lives for the pain.
I do.
That's so good.
I mean,
it's so good.
So you add Rook Cast, now 35 points, but you have 2 red, 6 black, 2 white.
She is 17 and a half points per wound.
She's only 35 to get the 2 wounds.
So she is the most expensive, but she's actually the cheapest.
You use Retinue Maul, and then whatever you did, whether you order them or didn't order them, take the other thing. I mean, you have your tokens.
We're approaching Magna Guard territory.
You want your tokens? Yes. You got your token.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I didn't need to even do any kind of, you know, shenanigans. I didn't have to have vigilance. I didn't have to have...
Awfully good. It's dumb.
I'm scared of where Legion is going.
So I will be fine if we get a good balance pass on previous cards.
Yes.
And I know they're going to have a very hard time saying this out loud, and I don't know that AMG will do it, but the Rebel Mandalorian should have always had more than the duelist option.
Yep.
I couldn't believe when they released them that was the only option they had. And I know they're like, oh, well, we have Tristan and Ursa, but they're unique. So you couldn't put them across multiple units.
It's a Palbiston problem.
It's a Palbiston problem, which, again, I think we need to pass on those guys as well.
Yeah, we do.
A further pass, not just adding their health to them. I think if we will do a strong balance pass on the original two armies, I think we'll be okay as a game in, here in the future. And maybe that's what Battle Forces are trying to do. Like, maybe that's what their attempt to do this is, to upgrade some things using other things we're going to sell you. Not to be talking about the capitalism, but here we go. I'm with you, Ryan. I see the worry. I feel the worry. I absolutely do.
They're not gouging with the recent upgrade for MCP. Like, the card pack is like $10 for a bunch of new cards.
Right. Oh yeah, and the card pack, and we know we're getting a card pack. I mean, so that is a good thing. Like, I see.
But we also already know what's in the card pack.
Yeah, yes. Our card pack isn't quite the revamp theirs was, but we're saying that when they did a rebalance with re-release cards, they didn't. It's not a $50 rule book.
This is easy to cry with Rebels, and I know a lot of the same things can be true of other factions, but Rebels and everything Shadow Collective has shown us has so many things that are just almost a one-to-one comparison.
Right.
You know, Black Sun are so similar, but just better in every way than Fleets. These Mandos are just so much better than Rebel Mandos. Gar or Saxon is just so much better than Sabine. Not to say that you know, like, obviously Gar needs help. Obviously, I think Empire's in an okay spot. There's a few keywords that need a change.
The Republic needs help, or Gar Saxon needs help?
See? It's already
Army
happening.
Of the Republic.
Well, I've never liked calling them Gar. Me anyway. Neither. I never have. I've always liked to call them Republic.
So,
you know, I like all faction nicknames equally. I never much cared for Gar.
So, and that's why I cry the most as a Rebel player, because the one-to-one comparisons are just so easy here.
Yes. Now, and I will say, we don't still know Battle Force composition, but even if you bring your mercenary core units, you're still going to have some bravery issues if you don't bring capos and leaders, because Allies of Convenience just allows you to order them. It doesn't allow you to claim your courage bubble for them. And so that does make a difference there. You're going to have some list building things that I think are going to get relatively expensive in order to get to the place to make sure that's a stable place for you. But you also have all the tokens. I mean, we talked about tokens. But like someone said, I don't know where I put some of these cardboard tokens, but I think I may need more for, you know, this mercenary faction coming up, because you're going to have so many tokens.
There's a promo I could do for another organization that may be putting out some tokens. I'm just saying. Keep your eyes open, the Legion community. Who could say? Maybe they have something to coincide with our next episode. You know, who could say? Who could say?
Hey, who could say? Who could say? But, you know, Ryan, I get it. I'm with you with this fear, but you're about to get something magnificent that was revealed at Celebration.
I mean, maybe we're going to get something. You're going to get soon is the key word. Oh, yeah. Like, fact, when is soon?
Because there's models. There's models.
There's models and they're painted. Yeah. We know. They're models and they're
painted. It's happening.
And this is where we're going to cue the music.
Never.
Yeah,
again.
We got Ewoks.
Never again.
So I know I've told the story before, and I'm going to tell it again because, gosh darn it, listeners, the story
is
so good.
It is fun.
Tim was doing some Twitch streaming. You know, he was experimenting with his online stuff, and I just happened to get home in time from work. I was like, I'll turn this thing on. Sure, we'll see what's going on here. And I literally get to the point, it is Tim, and his sweaty voice is like, I don't know where they are. And the screen is mostly dark. I'm like, what the? And on the screen, he strikes a flare because he's playing Battlefront. So he's playing a Stormtrooper. I'm like, cool. What is? And then my stereo speaker, I hear the lonesome sound of tiny bear trumpets, and Tim just goes, "Oh God, oh God, where are they?" And out of the darkness comes this Ewok, and it is horrifying.
It was the magic of being in the dark and like the glow. Cause say what you want about Battlefront 2, the graphics are gorgeous, and
yes,
the glow of the blaster rifles like lighting up the darkness of the Force, and just in your own glow, you're shooting at the Ewok that's far away. Then in the glow, you see the one that's suddenly in front of you with the fucking spear. You're going, yep, yep. And you're like, oh my God.
And all you catch is the message, Robert 745 has died.
No. That's not the message. It says Robert 444 or whatever has been taken by the jungle.
You're right.
And then you become an Ewok. So it's like, it's basically cannibalism, more or less.
To hunt your friends. It's a fantastic video game thing. I never thought, I just caught it
it's
randomest
the best
of
part
times.
Of Battlefront 2. That's it.
It's the best part. Yeah. Best part is Tim's discovering this new mode for the first time.
When it says Ewok hunt, I was like, oh, cool. I'm going to go hunt Ewoks. What a great time.
No.
And then as soon as it drops you in the forest, you go, oh, I've mistaken the... I did not understand the assignment, and I am in danger.
So you know how these things work. It's celebration. So it's a bunch of photos on Twitter. A certain YouTuber took a lot of photographs of people's legs before we finally got the camera straight before showing actual celebration. But we have Ewoks. They have been announced. They showed us all the model pictures, and yeah, they are magnificent.
They are hilarious.
I love them.
So you're on the internet. We'll post up some things. In fact, I think we probably already have at some point. But you can clearly see they're going to be a core unit, because we have lots of core style, like you've got Ewoks with spears and like four different poses here.
Yeah. And thematically, it makes sense that they're core, since we see like all the heroes and special forces on Endor, right, and like the bulk of the army was Ewoks.
And of course, yeah, they did not talk about battle forces. We don't know how they'll be arranged, but this is clearly going to be, you know, an Ewok battle force, because you have this beautiful, fantastic Ewok captain. I can't even describe him any better. Like, he's got the big staff and the headdress, and they standing on top of a battle log. I mean, so he's clearly going to be like a Wookiee commander kind of thing. Like,
if he doesn't get a force slot, I'm going to be disappointed.
You've got this Ewok slinger in the background, which I'm hoping is your ranged heavy. In this photo, though, they've got two different versions of it. So I don't know, or three different versions. So I don't know if your core unit's going to come with options like, you know, I don't know, but you've got three different model builds for the slinger. You've got three models for the spear throwers. You do have one that's got the beautiful little horn there. So, you know, you're going to have, I'm assuming it's a special.
Inspire, probably.
Yeah, probably Inspire. You've got one with like a tomahawk. It's just magnificent. And then you've got one guy, this is like a captain, like just a leader of your Ewoks. And another guy carrying rope. I don't know where he's going or what he's doing with that, but I feel like I'm hoping we get some kind of sapper explosive guy out of it. Like, I just don't know. But yeah,
it's going to be cool. I'm excited.
Magnificent. And of course, they're also tiny because they're Ewoks. Like, they're slightly taller than Yoda, I think, by scale comparison to the AT-ST that's behind them in this photo.
It'll be glorious. I've watched Ewoks ruin the Star Wars LCG card game many, many years ago, and I can't wait for them to do it again in Legion. Ewoks everywhere.
I mean, it's just, and then of course they released a picture of the Mandalorian in Grogu, the baby,
which we all knew was coming because, and of course, know,
just
they like
as
money.
A friendly reminder, remember that they are two separate unit bases. They are not one oddly like amoeba shaped base that someone recommended to me.
Oh, no. that was only Brett, and that's
no, it wasn't only Brett. That's Brett, the sad
think,
thing.
Was it not?
No.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was actually a lot more people than
it was someone really I used to them respect badly.
Yes.
Yes. And if you're looking on your phone, go look on a larger monitor, because that's really it's like in the darkness of a phone how sometimes the lighting settings are. It did. Their bases look like they're melded together.
Yes.
And I was like, okay. But then, on a regular computer screen, it's clearly just two little round. But Grogu, my God, he's super tiny. Like, I don't even so know tiny. How you're going to paint
What's
that.
What's frustrating is I know that Grogu is going to have secret mission, and I hate it. But
well, here's the thing about that Grogu model, too. I'm 99.9% sure I'm no expert. I'm pretty sure that Grogu is overscaled.
Yeah, it's too big.
He's too big.
It's way too big.
Yes.
I think because if you get any smaller, you're like
you
a
can't
15
paint it.
Mil.
Yeah.
Like, you're a 15 millimeter model.
I think
just,
we actually, got, funny enough, I think we got a size appropriate one at LVO. It's a little like 3D printed.
Yeah, the baby.
It's itty bitty tiny. Yeah.
It's amazing. But yeah, that one is actually more to scale than this one is.
Well, so this, this is a toddler. This is season 3 Mandalorian. We're catching ourselves a very beautiful, preview.
Yeah, for sure. No idea on release dates of this. No idea on anything, when this stuff will come. But it is exciting news. So maybe I just have to quit my complaining about Mandalorians and kill them with spears and...
Kill them with your Mandalorians. Just do a Mando fight. That's it.
Surging red save slap.
Yes. And then
a surging red save.
And
Ewoks.
Then even though you're losing that fight, you'll still win because you have R2. So there you go. That's all that matters.
Okay.
That's all that matters. That's it.
It'll be a mercenary unit.
R2 should be a mercenary unit. That way I could have him too.
Tim, I hate to break it to you, but the army you took this weekend not only could have used R2, but R2 would be remarkably good in.
Maybe. I like having 4 core. I hate running 3 core with a passion.
R2 healing a tank seems okay, and then waddling away to score victory.
I only needed him to heal once. My tank only damage twice and only died once.
I get bad control for that. I do. I feel that. I'm with you on that, Tim. I mean, R2 is very good, but it's bag is an issue.
Yeah,
putting R2 into my list.
Yeah. Yes. Ooh. But I mean, you know, I like the idea of battle forces because it allows you to be thematic without forcing your hand. Or I'm going to make these paint look like this, but they're actually going
to
be those things.
And before Ben makes a transition to Gungans, it's time to end the show.
Please, God, no.
We're just gonna preempt this. We're gonna end on Ewoks as God intended.
I was so heading to the Gungans because George.
Nope. Stop it. Nope. Thanks for spending your drive time, your paint time, any time that you wanted to spend with us. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slowski, reminding you, you should probably tip your TO. It's called bribery.
Don't listen to that. I'm Will Heim, reminding you that I hid from Al Paz. Yes, I ducked right out of him. I said, nope.
I'm Tim Hander, reminding you that I played Legion as well this weekend.
That's good, buddy.
There you go. And maybe I'll never play again.
It's always been a last fella. Game. You never know till it's already happened.
Oh, that's true.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you, know the story of George R. Binks.
No, censored.
Because the legends tell us the story of this man, the father of George R. And it's amazing, guys. I'm just going to be honest. It's amazing. Go to Wikipedia. Look it up. I did not even know.
It's a sad story. It's sad and terrible.
I didn't even know it. Who does that to these stories? I don't understand. Who authorized it?
Good night, everyone.
Because we know how hard it is for Lucas to authorize our scorebooks.
Please stop talking.
George R. R. Martin just based his name off of George R. Binks.
I tried, everyone. I tried, audience. I'm sorry.
Good night, everybody.
Failed you.
Good night.
You know who won't have a good night? George R. Binks. That's all.
That's true. I need to pause a moment. I'm having a issue with my cat. Stop attacking those.
Oh, this is definitely going in as a...
Yeah, this is 100% our blue
mark. Oh, thanks, Will. Here, we thought we were going to be talking about Jar Jar's suicidal father, but nope. It's the cat that gets the story.
No, I'm the disappointed father. No.
Yeah. Buddy, no.
I am not. I love Daisy. No, stop it.
Tim, if we asked you to think of Ayla, you would be like, oh, click.
Yeah.
You mean Nala?
Nala, sorry.
Yeah, you're close. I mean, we're waiting for you to get done.
We're waiting on you, man.
I know. I know you're talking to your cat.
Discipline your cat.
Do you want me to start with these command? Okay.
I got this. All right.
Okay. Remember, this is Will's faction now.
Well, so yes, I understand that.
Yeah. So,